Fill her up.
You're listening to the Gas Digital Network.
What up? What up? What up, podcast party people? I'm putting on my sexy voice now. Party people. Sexy podcast party people. That's right. I get all close to the mic and then I can. It's almost like the ASRM stuff. No, I can't stand that stuff. Oh my God, it drives me crazy. I don't know what it's. There's a whole like niche for that on YouTube. So weird. It's weird. I guess people get turned on by that shit. Not me. That shit don't turn me on. That doesn't turn me on. No. I don't know. I mean, if I guess it was my wife and she was saying some sexy stuff in my ear, and I guess that's what the thing is. But sometimes it's just like a chick reading like a fucking cookie recipe or something. why is this sexy? This is not sexy time. I should be in the studio right now. I'm in the studio working on new music, but I took time out to do a podcast today. I did Bjorn from Soil Work, though that's not who's on this podcast that you're about to hear. I'm doing the intro for the Trevor Black Dahlia murder thing, but I did his last week and I'm doing this week. I'm actually ahead of the game. That's right. I've got so many podcasts under my belt. I can actually delay doing the intro for almost a week. That's how I'm rolling. That's how I'm rolling these days. Happy about that. You know, sometimes you go through, especially at the beginning of the year, like nobody wants to do a podcast. They're like, it's January. I don't want to do a podcast. Fucking, I don't want to talk to you. I don't have anything to talk about. So it's been a struggle getting guests. And now it's like summertime. I don't know what it is, but like just I can't schedule enough people right now. So good problems to have. You know what I mean? Good problems to have. I can't complain. But yeah, like in April when my mom passed away, I actually didn't have any guests lined up. I was like, fuck it, good. And I think with the pandemic, it's like, I don't know, people are coming out of it's like the doldrums. You know, we finally got into summer and now everybody's like, the sun's out, like I'm out, sun's out, buns out, sun's out, guns out. You know what I'm saying? I know my gun's been out. I went camping. I got no shirt on. I've actually got a tan finally. I've got some sun on my face, on my body. My chest and my fucking legs were so white. God. Between the pandemic and just not, oh my God, my legs were so fucking white. Now they got a little bit of sun. They got a little bit of sun and I like it. I like it. And even though we still have a month left of summer, my kids just went back to school. And it feels like summer's over. I don't know. Whenever my kids go back to school, and now they're both in high school, which is fucking mind-boggling to me. Mind, or as Mudbilly, my former drum tech Mudbilly, used to say, mind-boggling. Mudbilly was from Kentucky. He'd say, hell, man, we'll get them on the next one, man. It's mind-boggling. I was like, mind-boggling? I'm like, mind-boggling. 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 It's what somebody said. What I was on a fucking taxi cab in New York right before the pandemic, too. And what did the guy say? It was he said it was something. He said mind-boggling. It wasn't mind-boggling, though. He said I can't remember. It was fucking funny. It was as funny as mind-boggling. And then I can't remember the joke, so now it's not funny to you. But yeah. Yeah, it's mind-boggling that my kids are in high school. I dropped him off this morning. Had to wake him up. I still got to wake him up, which is really irritating to me. I'm like, you're in fucking high school. Like, why do I have to wake you up? And my wife has got my kids so fucking spoiled. They're like, got to make them breakfast and make them lunch. I'm like, you're 17. Fucking wake up on your own and make your own shit. I would say motherfucker, but I don't say motherfucker to my kids. Motherfucker. Fucking, I got to make your fucking breakfast. Got to make your lunch. It's a sandwich. Throw three pieces of meat. I make some pretty fancy. We make some pretty fancy sandwiches, I got to say. I made him a fancy sandwich today. We had this ciabatta roll, it's called. It's like a type of bread. It's like a roll. It's fucking super good. I had one yesterday. I was like, I hardly ever have bread, but this shit was so good. I took the ciabatta roll, and then I put some avocado on it, and then I put three pieces of this lemon pepper chicken. It's like turkey, but it's actually just chicken because it tastes better to me. And then I had some bacon from the weekend, this extra thick bacon, and I fucking put that on there. And some onion. My neighbor gave me these homemade marinated jalapeno peppers. They're like red peppers and jalapeno peppers. I don't know what kind of peppers the red ones are, but they're also spicy like a jalapeno. And these things are fucking awesome. Oh my God. They're so good. And so I put those on there, and then I put some lettuce and tomato. We had one of them yellow tomatoes. I think it's called an heirloom tomato. Oh, it was fucking, I was looking at the sandwich and I put cheese and mayonnaise. I was like, dude, you better come home and just give me a hug when you like taste this sandwich. Like, that was the best sandwich ever. You ain't getting no sandwich like that from Subway. Hell no. Hell no. So I made him sandwiches, and then when I make Wyatt's very simple. He doesn't want all that shit on there. He doesn't want peppers or onions or lettuce. He doesn't want anything. All he wants is meat and cheese. So I made him salami, cheese, cheddar cheese, and mayonnaise. And then just on regular sourdough bread. Not the ciabatta. I just felt it was a little, just keep it simple with that kid. You never know. He's very, wants everything very separated on the plate. Doesn't want any food touching any other food. Although, he'll eat a piece of lasagna and not care one bit, like that it's all touching. I'm like, what does it matter? Like, you know. He's getting better, though. We've kind of told him his whole life, like, yeah, as you get older, like, your tastes change. You're going to like more food. You're going to like these other things. And he's finally starting to branch out. Now he's starting to like certain foods and other things and spreading out. He's all about the pesto. I make some homemade pesto. I've been fucking a cooking machine on the pandemic. I've got my fucking cooking skills have improved dramatically. I'm about to fart. Oh, you probably heard that. You probably heard that. Woo. That might be smelly one too. It's my protein shake in the morning. I have my I'm blowing it away. Oh my gosh. Whew, that's a stinky fart. Holy smokes. This might be the first time that I farted on the podcast. You know that? That might be my first on-air fart for the podcast. In damn near 2 years of doing the podcast, that's pretty good. Pretty good that I've managed to make it this far without farting while I do an intro or even a podcast. I can't recall farting during a podcast. Not that I would have a problem with it unless it was really loud. Then I'd be like, whoa, dude, sorry. Or chick, I'm sorry. Girl. I wouldn't call her a chick. I'd call her a girl. Here's a burp, too. There's a burp. I've burped already, though. I know that for a fact. That was the first on-air podcast fart, though. How about that? Mark this day down. August 16th. No, August 17th. So, yeah, now I can't remember what I was talking about. Let's see, what else has been going on? Let's see, a bunch of tours have canceled, and all these bands are going out on tour. So last week, Sebastian Bach had to cancel because he got COVID. Fall Out Boy had to blow out three dates because they canceled because somebody in their camp got COVID. Now, this week, as of just yesterday, Korn had to cancel like eight dates. I mean, 2 weeks. Jonathan Davis, sadly, caught the coronavirus, which was kind of surprising. I would have figured they would have had some, you know, they're playing amphitheaters in pretty big places. I would have figured they had some protocols in place. And, yeah, man. Shout out to Jonathan Davis. Sucks. It's some shit. And sucks for all the fans. Fuck. What a mess. But I guess they canceled two dates and then they had to reschedule the rest of them, which, just so you know, is fucking so much goddamn money. It's crazy. You know, like, the tour is going to end in the East Coast and now they got to sit out for 2 weeks and then they got to drive all the way back and, you know, basically start the tour over again to finish these dates. I mean, this is what I imagine is a financial disaster, but, you know, good on them for doing it. Very cool that they're still honoring the tickets for the fans. I'm sure the fans will be stoked. Yeah, that's what we've been worried about. Like, we can't stomach a fucking financial blow like that. Like, we just can't, man. Like, losing that many shows and having to sit around. I mean, there's been a couple tours where we've, you know, I think that first Catharsis tour, I got really sick. I forget what I got, but something happened. And then even like the last Burn My Eyes tour, I lost two dates in the U.S. and fuck, man, it was devastating for us financially. And on the Catharsis tour, I think we lost five shows. It was fucking brutal. You know, but yeah, I'm waiting till we're waiting till shit pans out. I haven't looked at the news today. I don't actually look at the news very much. I try not to go onto I don't go onto the blabbermouths very much. I don't go onto the metal injections or the metal sucks. Like, I do peruse them from time to time, but, you know, it's pretty rare. I don't have any of them in my feeds. I've got Revolver in my feed, I think. But they don't really post news stuff, which is good, because I don't want to see what their news stories are. They just put, like, happy birthday to Typo Negative's Bloody Kisses, shit like that, you know. They wished me a happy birthday. I was very happy about that. Revolver and Loudwire did. Revolver and Loudwire. And I don't know who else did, but it was cool. I all of a sudden, I saw a picture of me in the feed all professional. I was like, whoa, happy birthday, Robb Flynn. It's freaking very cool. It was very cool, man. Very cool. And then I saw a bunch of the fans. I saw a bunch of the head cases with your birthday wishes. I tried to like as many of them as I could. Sometimes it was just a bit much. So I got to as many as I could in chunks. You know, 'cause I didn't want to spend all day on the fucking internet. I tell you what, I was on the fucking phone forever yesterday, just looking at scrolling and just texting. Oh my God, my thumbs are killing me today. Like, the fucking joint that connects my hand to my thumb. Oh, it's so sore. I'm fucking old. I'm old. This is what happens when you get old. And this is the type of problems you have when you're old. Your fucking thumbs hurt from texting too much or scrolling too much, doom scrolling too much. Yeah, I was on the internet for a long time. You know, yesterday was the day that Afghanistan fell to the Taliban. The government collapsed and was taken over. So I was watching a bunch of doom scrolling. Yes, it was doom scrolling about that and watching these poor people trying to hang off of an airplane and as it takes off and trying to get out. And oh, what a mess. I reached out to a friend of mine, Ozman. Shout out to Ozman. And he, you know, he had been to Afghanistan. And I was like, I want to talk to a veteran today. Like, I want to reach out to someone who was there, someone who lived it, someone who fought that war. And not just listen to pundits and the fucking news and the internet and whatever. And he was just like super torn, you know, totally gets why we're doing it. It's been 20 years. He was there fucking back when it started, 2004 or whatever, 2005 or something. So, and he was like in the shit, like he was interrogating terrorists. In fact, he gave me an American flag that was hung over on the wall where they interrogated terrorists. And, it was pretty special that he gave that to me. And, you know, I was just talking to him and I was like, hey, you know, fucking, what do you think of all this? He was like, man, he's like, I'm just super torn. And, you know, on the one hand, I totally get why we're pulling out. It's been 20 years, billions of dollars, and we can't keep doing it. And on the other hand, he's like, and then on the other hand, he's like, they didn't want to fight. Like, he's like, they didn't want to fight. You know, we trained them, we funded them, and then, you know, it still happened. And it was like, fuck. I don't know. It was good just to hear his, it was good to hear his take on it. You know, but it was pretty heavy. And it's still going on. It's like pretty heavy duty. Biden came out and stood by his decision. Many people were critical of him. But I kind of get it too, man. Like, 20 years, I mean, three presidents. Two terms of Bush, two terms of Obama, one term of Trump, now 7 months into his thing. It's a fucking long time. It's a fucking long time to be at war with a country that we invaded under the premise of 9/11. You know, we invaded Afghanistan after 9/11 because supposedly that had some connection with the terrorists, which at the time seemed legitimate. What we now know, 20 years later, is that 15 of the 19 hijackers that crashed their plane into the Twin Towers on September 11th were Saudi Arabian. Two of them are from Lebanon. One of them is from Pakistan or something. None of them were actually from Afghanistan or Iraq, for that matter. And yet, we invaded Afghanistan, and we invaded Iraq. Bizarrely did not invade Saudi Arabia, even though 15 of the 19 hijackers were Saudi Arabian. Oh, let's go invade Afghanistan. Like, what? You know, it'd be like if your next-door neighbor, the Johnsons, robbed your house, and then the neighbors across the street, the Fredericks, you know, the neighbors across the street, the Fredericks, who didn't do anything, you're like, and you found out, oh yeah, it was the Johnsons who did it. Oh, let's go fucking challenge the Fredericks. Like, wait, what? I don't know if that's a good point. I don't know if I made a good point there, but I hope you know what I hope you know where I'm going with that. So, yeah, you know, I wrote a whole album about this called The Blackening and how against the war we were, because we believed even back then, 2005, 2006, when that record was getting written, that invading them and Iraq was wrong. And I don't feel any differently. So to see it all come to an end 20 fucking years later is kind of wild. And, you know, it seems like this collapse has been a long time coming. So here in the Bay Area, to switch from that, it's really smoky, man. Holy fuck. You know, the fires here, the fire's pretty far away, actually. Like, the main fire, it's up in Northern California, probably 200 miles away, but fuck, it's so gigantic that it's just leaving the entire Bay Area covered in smoke. It's so fucking smoky out. And, you know, you go out and, like, it's just like this orange haze around the sun, and it's not safe to really be out and breathe, but, you know, if you gotta go out and do shit, walk your dogs or whatever. But I hear over in Europe, man, holy shit, I've been watching, like, it's like 124 degrees in Italy, and fucking Greece's heat waves and crazy fires. Like, it's fucking nuts, man. Nuts. It's been a wild summer. It's actually been fairly cool here, which has, I think, been to our benefit, because if the heat was raging, I think we'd be having more fires, and I'm grateful that we aren't. It's actually been very cool. It's actually, it's like 70 degrees here today. So for August, that's in California, that's fucking cold. Very mild weather. But yeah, man. That's what's going on here. What else has been going on? What else has been going on? Like I said, we're in the studio. recording some new music, working on some new music, getting ready to try to finish up some new songs. We got a week booked out. There's not going to be a happy hour this week because we've got a week booked out for working on new jams. And this is why I think we're going to start doing this. We're going to start doing like a week in the studio, just bash it out as much as we can and get as much accomplished as we can riff-wise. I probably need to be delivering a record by January. So it's now August 17th. Yeah, so I got about 4 months before I got to deliver a record. So I need to start hunkering down. I need to start hunkering down and writing. I don't know. I've been very uninspired lately. I don't know. Riff-wise, I've been inspired. Musically, I've been inspired. But lyrically, I just can't even sit down in front of and write lyrics. And I just haven't. I don't know why. It's like I'm just fucking lazy. I'm getting mad at myself for being so lazy. Like, I need to step up and do this. So one of the things I hope to accomplish is all these lyrics I've written, I'm just going to try and I'm gonna start singing them and then see what happens. You know, sometimes when you write a song, like, you don't know where you're going. Like, you're just fucking writing. Like, okay, what's this song about? Is it about fighting? Is it about struggle? Is it about happiness? Is it about sadness? Is it about violence? Is it about fucking who knows what? War? Whatever. A lot of time you just got to let the music take you on the journey that it wants to take you. And so I got to start doing that. And I feel like, you know, now that the kids are in school, like, our life's sort of back to normal again with the pandemic, like, I'm a little more ready to do it. But I don't know. I've been feeling kind of off my game. I don't know why. Just feeling kind of out of it. Kind of feeling shitty sometimes, too. You know, I went to jerk off the other day, and I couldn't even, like, entertain myself enough to do that. I was like, what the fuck? Which happens sometimes. Usually in the morning. Like, sometimes I'm on tour, and I'm like, wake up. It's like 5 in the morning. I'm like, gosh, just jack off and go back to sleep. I'm trying, can't sleep. And sometimes I just can't even, like, finish jacking off. I'm like, wow, like, that's pretty sad. You can't. Pretty sad state of affairs. Yeah. I did that the other day. I got up and tried to jack off in the morning. I was like, no, fuck. Couldn't even. I was like, all right. I guess that's not what we're doing today. No need to do that today. I went out to a bar the other day for the first time in a year and a half. I had a Friday. My wife and kids went out of town for a minute to go to visit their cousin. And cousin Paul, who got married. Shout out to cousin Paul. Not that he listens to my podcast. But, so I was like, I came back, and one of Xander's coaches lives right around the corner from me. And so I was like, I'll see what Coach Steve is doing. He was always cool, like, you know, cool dude. And we've been talking about getting together and having some beers. And so I was like, let's go. And so there's a bar right down the street from my house. And I was like, let's go over there and we'll walk and don't got to drive. And fucking, we go down there and, like, it's fucking closed. It's like 8:30 on a Friday and it's closed. I'm like, what the fuck? So he's like, let's go into Martinez and we'll fucking go rage in there. And I was like, I got a couple of bars. And so we go in this one bar and it's called Whiskey Lane. And it's a cool bar. You know, I'd never been there. And I haven't gone drinking really in any of the bars in Martinez. And because I just, you know, after we had kids, I just stopped going out to bars really. Anyway, it's the first time I've really been in a bar forever. No masks. The fucking security guards aren't wearing masks. The fucking the bartender, nobody's wearing a mask. I'm like, there's a mask mandate in California. I'm like, oh, hell no. So I go in, I get my cocktail. I'm like, let's go sit over by the door that's open with fresh air. You know, it starts getting pretty full. And I'm like, I last about 20 minutes. I'm like, I got to get out of here. Like, I can't. I don't know what's going on with the world, but I don't want this. So we go over to some brewery, and the brewery had, like, open seating. It was all outdoors. I was like, all right, let's kick it out here. This is good. I'm cool with this. got recognized. Some dude recognized me. It was cool. And it was just a good vibe. We hung out with him and talked about, you know, life. And, you know, his mom had just passed away and my mom had just passed away. So we were talking about that. Kind of very similar circumstances with, like, you know, being very medicated. And so it was a good hang, but it was just weird going out. I got to say, it was so weird going out to a bar. It was so bizarre. I just hadn't been to a bar in forever. Well, I want to say probably 2 years since I've been to a bar. Probably 2 years. I see everybody all unmasked, and I was just like, oof, I'm not ready for this. I'm not ready for this yet. Might be a little longer before I'm back in bar life. Anyway, enough of my travails here. What am I got going here? I've got, let's see. You know what I've got? This is what I got. Loving is what I got. Just remember that. I said loving is what I got. Check this out. Trevor Black Dahlia Murder right here. Number one song on Spotify. What a horrible night to have a curse. Number one song. You guys are riff-tastic. This is off the first record, I believe. Yeah. Oh, not their first record. This is off of Nocturnal. This right here, Nightbringers. Number two song, the latest 2017 album. This right here, Statutory Ape. Number one song off of their debut album, Miasma. I think I'm saying that right. Miasma. This is Necropolis off of Deflorate. But check it out. This right here. Their new album, Verminous. Came out and killed it. This is the title track right here. There you go, ladies and gentlemen. A little taste of the Black Dahlia Murder if you've never heard it. So right now, I bring to you the mighty, mighty Trevor from the Black Dahlia Murder.
Yo.
Hey.
How you doing, buddy?
Good, man. How are you?
Good.
Trevor Strnad. It's been a while, man.
Yes. It's a Strnad, actually.
But sorry, what is it? What is it?
Strnad.
Strnad. Trevor Strnad.
Most people just skip it, dude. It's fine.
All right. Let me try it again. Trevor Strnad.
Yep. How you doing? It's been a long life with that one.
Yeah, right. I'm like partially dyslexic. I miss letters and I put A's and like.
Yeah, that one's got enough missing as it is.
Right. This is quite the gothy background you've got there.
Yeah, it's either this or like shit tons of sun. So I thought that I have like all these blackout curtains closed and nice. Yeah.
I was trying to think the last time that I saw you or talked to you. I want to say it was just that tour.
Yeah, I think so, man. I think so. Yeah.
Almost 10 years ago at this point.
Yeah, that's wild, dude. That was a long time ago.
I know, that was a long time ago. You still have, I think you had just gotten Andy at that point, your drummer. Was he in the band at that point?
The blonde Alan, guy? Yeah. He was Alan. New. That was his first tour with us ever, man. So that was right. Kind of, you know, like jumping him in, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Definitely a good way to start. And
he's still with you, right?
Yeah. He's killing it, man. He's great.
Fucking sick. God
damn. Best guy we've had, man. He's actually a tolerable human too, you know? It gets hard when you get up there with the really fast, talented guys, man. A lot of it comes with ego, you know?
Right. You've had some great drummers though, man. Like you, Shannon Lucas and.
Yeah, he was killer, man. He was killer. Yeah. We've had a good run.
Are you excited about your tour? Your tour starts pretty soon here, right?
Yeah, man, I'm excited. But then every time I go to Twitter, I get like beaten down a little bit. Cause like, so there's so much naysaying about COVID and stuff on there. And I'm like sweating a little bit. You know what I mean? I
feel
like
naysaying from your fans or there's naysaying just
across the board, pretty much, man. Yeah. That's where you go for negativity anyways, Twitter, right?
I did a podcast yesterday and I went on Twitter right before and I was like, I did my intro. I was like, now I'm all fucking pissed off.
Yeah, god damn it.
But what's going, the tour starts pretty soon though, right?
Yeah, September 3rd is the first date in Chicago and it goes till October 10th in New York.
Yeah. Are you nervous that you don't think it's going to happen?
Yeah, or like certain parts of it won't happen, you know what I mean? And like, I'm just worried that like maybe different mandates are going to pop up and derail things, or, you know, I've already seen backlash about people that the UC theater is requiring,
masks, right?
Masks and you know, proof of, vaccination stuff, okay. Which I think is great personally, but you know, there's a lot of people on the other side of that. And I'm already seeing some people like wanting to get rid of their tickets and shit because of it. And it's like, fuck, man, just get vaccinated. What's the big deal?
Yeah. I mean, UC theater. I mean, I think all of California has a mask mandate going at
right,
least every place
yeah.
you're going to be playing, you know, maybe.
Right. When it, that was the first thing I saw come back that kind of like was like, oh, fuck. You know what I mean? Kind of like, hopefully not telling of too many things to come, but. Yeah, as soon as I saw that Cali was back with the mask mandates, started sweating a little bit.
Motherfuckers,
I feel like
better start practicing their cardio now.
Yeah, no shit.
You're gonna be getting tired in that pit with a mask on.
Yeah, no doubt.
Yeah, but that hasn't really affected any other areas right now.
No, like we haven't gotten any bad news. I feel like I'm waiting for the axe to fall, kind of like for something to come down from management or booking, but. All systems are go so far. Everything's looking good. Ticket sales are killing it. You know, I think people are really eager to get back out there. And
yeah, I saw like Seattle sold out. And
yeah, I mean, Seattle's a pretty small spot, but some of the shit we did, you know, like Denver's like 1,350 tickets. You know,
that's awesome.
Pretty rocking for us. You know,
yeah, that's killer. Did I lose you there?
No, I'm back. Just getting some potatoes out of my ear, you know.
Yeah, good for you guys, man. Good for you. That's killer.
Thanks.
Yeah, I'm excited for you. I'm excited, and I'm like, you know, crossing my fingers, like, fuck, I hope this works out.
Yeah, please.
For every band that's going out right now, you know.
Just, yeah, I feel crazy. Like we're all right at that line right now where it's hard to say what's going to happen, you know what I mean? And you know, I see people that have tours that are even later than ours that are out just, you know, like bumming out already and stuff. And it's just like, fuck, man, I'm trying to stay positive here.
Yeah.
Trying to will it into existence, you know.
have you done a live stream, right?
Yeah, we did a live stream. We kind of like kicked and screamed the entire way. We didn't want to do it.
Oh no.
Well, you know, we all live in different corners of the states, and you know, right. Just like the amount of money to fly everyone together and to practice a while, kick the dust off and shit. But yeah, I'm happy with how it came out. You know, we threw it together really fast for how the end product came out. And I think we're about to like segue it onto some kind of streaming platform or like get it back out there for the fans. You know, it was kind of hung up by legalities for a while there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we had Neil Hamburger host. Like he was like the announcer for the thing.
Neil Hamburger.
Yeah, he did a great job. He killed it. You know, he was kind of the perfect guy to like fit in with our kind of weird sense of humor. You know what I mean? But having him involved has kind of made it a lot more like legal hoops to jump through.
Gotcha.
You know what I mean? Getting it put onto other platforms and stuff. But they liked it. You know, his campaign, they were happy with how it came out. And so, yeah, just trying to get it back out there. And hell, Christmas isn't that far off again now. So, right. You know, hopefully by then.
Is that the only show you've played since the pandemic hit?
Yeah, we were in South Africa. We did two shows with like some new material before the new record even dropped.
Oh, okay.
But you know, now like I consider that the end of the last touring cycle, kind of. You know what I mean? There's been so much time between then and now.
That was during the pandemic?
It was right when stuff was going to shut down. Like it kind of started shutting down while we were there.
Okay.
And you know, we started to get nervous about coming back and the flights back, but everything went off without a hitch. But yeah, that was the moment when we really were like, yo, this Testament tour is going down the toilet.
right. That was supposed to be in April or something, right?
Right, dude. It was right before the record dropped. So it was kind of like the perfect storm, or it would have been, you know what I mean? It was going to be the biggest tour we'd done to date. I mean, you could say Meshuggah might have been that, but like that was only 10 days. You know what I mean? This was a full scale, full US thing. Direct support for Testament. Finally got Municipal Waste on a bill with us. We've been wanting that forever. You know, fucking awesome band. Great dudes.
Totally.
And just a total wet dream of a tour, man. And, you know, we would be there with the new record, all the new merch and new backdrop and all that exciting shit, and be able to make puppy dog eyes at people at the merch table to buy the record. You know, so like we lost definitely some serious, you know, potential momentum with that. And it kind of like hurt how it dissolved, really. It's, you know, it's not really coming back in that form ever. You know, Testament's doing their own thing. We've got our own thing now. Municipal's got theirs.
Right.
Just another fart in the wind, man. Just how the shit happens, you know? Like, it's, I've learned to not get too excited, man. You know what I mean? Like, you have to, like, just be prepared for fucking anything, man. This shit gets derailed so easily.
And, like, it's like the life of being in a band. Keep your expectations low.
Oh, yeah, dude, for sure. I've broken my own heart a zillion times over the years over this shit. And now I'm just kind of like, all right, I'll believe it like when I'm on stage with the mic in my hand. You know what I mean? And you know how it is like assembling a tour? Like people don't realize this, but the tour that you finally put on the flyer and get out there is plan Z. You know what I mean? Right. Like the original lineup that you wanted and tried for like almost never pans out. You know what I mean? Like, you know, we've been lucky like a few like perfect storms in the early days, you know, but like, yeah, man, it's always just a fight. You know, people don't realize the give and take and the egos involved and just money, the stuff with money is so complicated.
Availability. Yeah, totally.
Availability. And then we deal with stuff like there's some bands we want to take out that are too underground. You know what I mean? That don't want to go with us necessarily. They think it's a bad look for their cred. Wow. You know what I mean? So, yeah, there's all kinds of like factors and
That surprises me. I mean, like, you guys are, I mean,
it does for
not
me
as
too, you
credible
know,
as it
like
gets.
I feel like at least we are for as high of a profile band as we are, you know what I mean? And we always try to rep the underground and take smaller bands that I like, you know, and give back in that way. And you know, I feel a tremendous obligation to shine a light on extreme metal. You know, I feel like even a lot of the publications I look at, and even some that I've worked for, like, I just feel like the stuff I really like doesn't have that much of a voice, you know what I mean? So, you know, I try to like do what I can, at least, you know, there's always compromise in the world of BDM, you know, like, kind of getting back to, you know, like the band isn't necessarily seeing how you see it yourself. You know what I mean? You can't really control that. You can't control who likes your band or who doesn't like your band or what like micro genre they want to fight about on the internet and call you, you know what I mean? Right. And like, at first I was kind of guarded about that. You know, I wanted to be really seen as this like strictly death metal entity, long hair, leather clad fans, you know, very typical kind of shit. And I think just by looking like Misfits kind of when we came out, you know, a bit more of a punk swagger, I guess, you know, we were, you know,
you guys had short hair,
right, you know, equally punk rock kids. And I remember kind of like being resistant to even take photos initially, I thought like, yo, let's fool these motherfuckers, you know what I mean, like, just let the record do the talking. The record, you know, is chock full of fucking of death metal, you know. And so yeah, it's been a really interesting trajectory that I had never imagined, you know, but the band has also risen to a level I had never foreseen. You know, I never saw us being on an Ozzfest or anything comparable to that. And I never saw us, I don't know, just being so versatile, I guess, you know what I mean? Like, we've played tons of shows with hardcore bands and deathcore and death metal and thrash and kind of everything in between. And, you know, we try to play to what our fans like, whether we are personally like it or not, you know what I mean? You have to you have to kind of like put your pride aside and do what's right for the whole band and the entity. And, you know, it hasn't gone exactly how I pictured, but I am very thankful for what we have. It's amazing to be this high profile as such an extreme band. And, you know, to still be going 20 years in, we just hit that 20 year mark, this year. And
congratulations, man.
No, thanks, dude. Thanks. Yeah, it just kind of snuck up on us, you know. We didn't really prepare for it or anything, and it was just like, Brian called me up, was like, hey man, 20 years today. Like, what? That is so sick. Yeah. So sick. But yeah, I can't wait to get back out there. And you know, it's been weird being in a band and being stuck in, and like, I'm kind of the guy keeping it together on social media, you know what I mean? So like, the other guys might be able to forget they're in a band for a day, you know what I mean? And like, relax, you know what I mean? But not me. Like, I've been like chomp, 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 chomp this entire time, you know. But having the record drop when it did, I think ultimately was more of a blessing than a curse, you know, like right at the beginning of the lockdown, people were still happy. They were still positive. They thought it was going to be a couple weeks.
Right.
You know, there wasn't any like,
by the summertime, this will be gone.
Yeah. You know, there wasn't any like rioting yet. It wasn't like completely like volatile politically yet. Right. And we had, you know, all this pre-recorded.
It was like
material.
April 2020, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Before, it was George Floyd.
Exactly, dude. It was the perfect time really to have this big storm of content. So like, I think we looked like a really huge band at that moment. You know what I mean? Like, all of a sudden every dude that runs a blog is stuck inside, so they want to get you on the horn. You know what I mean? I feel like we quadrupled the press that we would have normally done just because of like the timing and things. And right at that moment, a lot of albums got put on hold. Ours was too far along in production. We couldn't stop it. You know what I mean? Like, if we wanted
vinyl was probably done.
Exactly. So, but yeah, like right at that moment, there wasn't a whole lot of albums coming down the lane. You know, it was really kind of, I don't know, kind of a perfect storm. We could have been stuck at the end of an album cycle with nothing to show for, no new content, and just kind of be like stuck in stasis. You know what I mean?
That's where we are. Yeah,
exactly. I think most bands kind of, that's what happened to most of them. You know what I mean? But we were very lucky to have all this pre-recorded stuff that we did, you know, for the album And yeah, the lane was clear right at that moment for, you know, it was like gave the world a Black Dahlia enema against their will.
A black enema.
Whoosh.
Yeah, that's good stuff, man. Hey, everyone. Today's episode is brought to you by martyrstore.net. Maybe you remember they did a limited run of Flynn's beef tees, as well as some Robb Flynn is my favorite rapper tees. Well, those sold out quick, and so will the new Respect the Neck t-shirts they just released in tribute to Cannibal Corpse's own George Corpse Grinder Fisher. Have you seen those shirts? They're awesome. So after the podcast today, head over to martyrstore.net and use code ROBB. That's my name, Robba, with two B's, and you'll save 10%. That's code ROBB at checkout. They also have some sweet prong coffee mugs, some Exodus pint glasses, plus merch from Hatebreed, Crowbar, Josta, D. Snyder, and more. martyrstore.net. And then you couldn't tour it, which must have just been the weirdest thing of your entire career to drop a record and then just like, okay, I guess we're stuck here
It
for a
is
while
weird.
now.
Like we're still, we've played, you know, a handful of the songs now because of the stream and shit.
The stream was
But
this year though, right?
yes,
Yeah.
but we're not comfortable yet. Now, the stream was last year actually. It was
Oh, was it? Okay, gotcha.
yeah, it was right before Christmas that it came out.
Okay.
But
Right, 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 right.
yeah, like that's the only time we've played the songs together in person, really. You know what I mean? So like we're not even like comfortable yet. I don't even know what the songs look like yet on stage, like stage presence wise. You
Right.
know what I mean? Like we haven't gotten there yet. So all this shit is still super new. It's kind of like it's just been like boop put on hold, you know what I mean?
I
So
totally know what you mean by like stage presence wise, or like you get up there and you're like, okay, what do I do now? Like I'm playing this new, do I, is it an A part? Is it a certain,
yeah, dude,
like,
it's weird that like it comes naturally and it doesn't, you know what I mean?
right.
Like it kind of takes a little time to like get it together and kind of like, you know, kind of you're vibing with your other bandmates
Right.
on what they're doing stage presence wise. And like, so yeah, you know, we have the stream, we have us playing those songs, and looking like we're not very comfortable doing it, you know what I mean? Which is true though, you know, like every record though, we bite off way more technicality, way more like Olympic shit to do, you know what I mean? It's kind of like a sadomasochistic thing that we do, you know, like we enjoy the torture, we enjoy pushing things to the next level and reaching, you know what I mean? Like even with the very first record, we couldn't play half the shit yet that we were doing, you know what I mean? We had the ideas and we're able to put them on the record, then we would go out and get our asses kicked by tour and kind of catch up, you know what I mean? And it's still like that. There's still stuff we're reaching for that we know we're going to be able to do if we really put our minds to it, you know what I mean? But yeah, there's always that kind of risk involved and this kind of inner thirst for more complexity, I think, more technical details. And the guys are just monster players, you know, they're always
Dude.
growing, they're always reaching new heights. And you know, every time we come back to write, like I'm a fan, you know what I mean? Like I get to hear it all first and I'm just like, whoa, man, like holy shit. And I try to rise to the occasion to keep up with these guys, but I feel like I'm mostly here because I'm a good orator. You know, I'm good at this part. You know what I
You're charismatic, you know, you're fucking,
mean?
you're
Yeah, that's
kind of
kind of
crazy
pulling
guy
me.
up there, you know, like, you know, it's
Yeah.
good. It's fucking awesome.
Charisma,
Killer
charisma.
lyrics, you know, fucking
Oh,
awesome
thank
lyrics, you
you.
know. Yeah, your guitar player Brian's sick, you know. And I remember your previous guitar player. I know you got a new guitar player now, but that Ryan guy that you had,
Ryan, yeah, he was
just
killer too, dude. Oh yeah.
fucking real,
Yeah,
man.
he hand selected Brandon too, and they're very much cut from the same kind of cloth, you know. They came up on the Shrapnel Records catalog of Shredder
Oh, nice.
albums,
Nice.
and you know, they're rocker dudes for sure at heart.
That's
And
killer.
so yeah, it was kind of funny bringing Brandon in, you know. He was like 24, this little guy, and his like favorite band is like Starship, you know.
Star
He's not like
Starship.
your normal.
Starship.
What exactly, dude? You know what I mean? Like he loves, like he's a
Yeah.
rocker, dude. He
Yeah.
seriously is, man.
I'm
He
trying to
loves
I'm brain farting on
Toto,
the guitar player's name, but
Starship.
Starship.
You know, like he's shown me tons of awesome old music. We sit around and listen to like AOR, dude. We'll have
Yeah.
like
He's
the
playing like the deep
backstage.
cuts though, right? Like he's playing
Oh
like the
yeah,
deep
dude.
cuts of
Like
those
he
bands, yeah.
loves it, man. He's
Not
shown me
Rebuilt
like
This City.
oh yeah, not that, man. He, you know, he's shown me like so many deep cut awesome like boat music bands, you know, where
Not
like
rock bands.
yeah, for sure, dude. You know, he's not like your typical, you know, 26-year-old metalhead, you
Yeah,
know,
that's
like
pretty wild, man.
he's definitely cut from like an old school cloth and the things
I
that
was
he
reading
did.
an interview, or I was watching an interview, and you were saying how he was really into like the glam, like the 80s glam guitar players, and obviously
Oh,
that's
for
when guitar playing
sure.
was, you know, the main focus, and when you did a lead, you had to fucking rip it hard. And
Right. Yeah. And, you know, and we've always been that band. Like, we've always prioritized guitar solos and, like, you know, we've had really great shredders. You know, Ryan was exceptional too, but Brandon, like, lives that kind of shredder dude. He walks it, he talks it. You know what I mean? Like, he's really exciting on stage. Dude practices at home and, like, fucking headbangs the whole set by himself,
oh
you know,
shit.
at, you know, like
That's
it
awesome.
is not a game to him. Like he works so hard at it. And it's basically his entire life. You know, he's a very quiet dude. He doesn't seem to like keep a whole lot of friends and stuff. Like he's just been so dedicated to music. Like even in high school, he wanted to become a professional musician and just like tunnel visioned on that. You know what I mean? Like every single day, go home and play guitar. You know, it wasn't about chicks, wasn't about hanging out and being an idiot. Like, and he seriously segued from he's never been in a local band.
Oh, really? Wow.
He's never been in some dumb, embarrassing band like we all have. You know what I
Yeah.
mean? Like
Like he went right to Black Dahlia?
he went right to like doing real gigs and filling in for like different bands.
Oh, okay.
I want to say
Wow, that's
he
crazy.
played for Azalea Dying for like a millisecond on a tour. I
Crazy.
know he played for Finn Troll, and he wore ears and was bare chested all set. And he had some other hookup through like some power metal bands out of New Jersey. He's a big power metal guy.
Okay,
I think
crazy.
somehow
Wow.
like through Pyramaze or something he ended up getting, and then he like you know got the gig in Arsis, and unfortunately for Jim, Arsis has kind of been like the monstrosity to our Cannibal Corpse. You
Okay.
know, like they're a great band, but they've never had as much momentum. They've had a kind of rocky, you know, history of like tours being canceled and stuff like that. And yeah, we're on our second guitar player that we've poached from them now. You know, sorry, Jim. I'm sorry. You know, we love you and Arsis. And Arsis is an influence on the band too. You know, it's a band that we love and we look up to. And you know, but
It's pretty
I mean,
wild to think that he never played any shows prior to, you know, like just, I think so
yeah,
much of being in a band
shows.
sometimes is like you start out and you just suck in front of 20 people in a living room
Right.
or
Yeah, it's
kill it in
weird.
front of 20 people in a
He
living room. Yeah.
like circumvented that whole like, yeah, my band is called Yellow Plastic Bucket and we sell tickets to get on the Harpo show. Like,
Right.
what? Like, how'd you do that? That's amazing. You know what I mean? Like, I've been in bands that like I would erase from time and history out of fear of being blackmailed.
No,
You
come
know
on
what I
now.
mean? Like some of my
Come
early
on
local
now.
bands. So like I don't know, like he's just really smart, dude. He's a really
Yeah.
smart kid. We've trusted him with so much like since joining the band. Like he pretty much produced the last record.
Oh,
He
wow.
recorded the lot of us at his house except for the drums. And you know that's the first time we've given somebody in the band that kind of control. Or that they wanted to take that kind of control. And, you know, he's the newest guy in the band, the youngest guy in the band. And it just
Right.
goes to show you like his influence on us and how like how much he's brought to the table. And like, you know, Verminous is very much his record, more so than the last one before. You know, he's been on two now, but I think he kind of got his legs creatively with us on Nightbringers. And then this one, you know, we gave him the keys to the city, dude. We're like, we trust you, man. You're a fucking mutant. Lead us into battle. Let's do this, you know.
And you know, I think for you guys, that's probably pretty cool because, you know, it's the young energy. You know, you guys have been doing
It
it for a
is
while to have that
cool.
like new, you know, fresh, unjaded. And, you know, not
Right.
saying that like, not saying that you're jaded, but like, you
Oh,
know,
I
just
am. Come
after,
on. It
you
is
know.
though. It's really cool to have new blood that's really excited about being here. And you know, he's like stepped into all these responsibilities so seamlessly. And, you know, it's exciting to have someone that we want to trust that is bringing that much creatively, that is thinking of things that we've never thought of, you know, like the way that he writes songs and the things that he's taught us about songwriting and the way he looks at music has just been insanely inspiring. And it's wild to have someone come in and shake the band up this much. Mm-hmm. At this, you know, after all these years, because we keep it very close, you know, we keep the cards very close to our chest. It's a very, you know, we're tight knit, a family affair. And, you know, we've produced all of our
style
records
that you want to keep.
Right, exactly. You know, and we've produced all of our stuff pretty much. You know, the only times I can look back and say that, you know, we did give people production credits, but I didn't know what the fuck I was talking about, pretty much is what it was. We've never had a producer sit in on any sessions and be like, no, you know, move the song around, do this, you know, like we've controlled everything anally as fuck every second of this entire band. And for to have someone come in and realize like, yo, this guy's like a fucking maniac, let's give him, you know, the power to do this shit and trust him and stuff. It's really exciting at this point, you know, to have like this kind of shot in the arm 20 years deep, you know.
Yeah, that's awesome. Good for you, man. You know, I totally get where you're coming from. You know, you need, like, I think when you're doing this for a while, you know, there's times when you just don't, you're trying to draw inspiration from something, you know, like, and, you know, sometimes it's from one place and maybe it works. And then other times you do it and it doesn't work. And, you know, to have a guy come in and, you know, I think when you have a style, you know, melodic death metal, he's able to write these crazy fucking riffs and play these crazy leads and do all this stuff. I mean, fuck, that's like perfect storm.
Oh, for sure. You know, and like his personal influence of like what he likes is creeping in more and more, you know, like
some Starship there was a riffs coming in.
Yeah, dude, really, like there was like the last record had like a Queensryche kind of riff.
Okay.
You know,
yeah.
Like some some rocking ass shit, some like early US power metal, like that's what he loves, man. You know, he loves that kind of stuff. So like the new stuff is more, there's more leather, there's more chains, there's more tassels, like, you know, like he's bringing it in. And, you know, we got songs on the new one where we close the hi-hat. If you would have told me we were going to close the hi-hat on a song 20 years ago, I just wouldn't have believed it. You know what I mean? Like I wouldn't have been able to picture a Black Dahlia Murder song,
right,
where we're just kind of rocking out like that, you know what I mean? And like we've pulled it off, and like that's him, man. He's a rocker. He's brought a lot of groove to the band, which is cool too. Alan, you know, can handle it. Like he's a very, very colorful drummer beyond just metal, you know.
He's
what I
sick.
Mean, like he's incredible. I feel like he's one of the best out there, and he doesn't really get the kind of props that he deserves.
Super nice guy too.
Yeah, yeah, he's great. I choose to sit by him in the van when we're in the van. That says something. Like he's the guy I sit next to.
Yeah, I remember. If you remember the tour that we did with you guys, that Death Clock thing was like a nightmare tour for us. Like it was just, if anything could go wrong, like wait, I had the hernia. Like I had to drop off.
I wanted to bring that up. I had a double hernia surgery during lockdown. And I thought how you fucking got up on stage like a day later and just continued the tour, and I would have fucking pussied out. There's no fucking way, man. I don't know how you did it, dude. I commend you like entirely.
Where did your hernia went?
I had one like on the side that brought me in. Like I felt it happen
on the side
when I was
of
working
what?
Out. Like
on the side of your nutsack?
Angle. No, it's like, you know, kind of just on the front. You know, where you're growing your pubes.
Yeah, right,
you know?
right. Yeah.
And then when I went in, they looked at my belly button and were like, yo, you notice there's a thumb sticking out of your belly button? And I was like, that explains why I feel like I can't do all the vocals I used to be able to do as well. You know what I mean? And so now I got that shit. I got my shit pushed in.
Yes.
I got my belly button pushed back in. They put like a mesh like wall behind it. And now, like, I feel like I have all this power back, and like, I've been really excited to sing and have this kind of renewed gusto for it, where I didn't know that it was dragging me down. Like, it kind of crept in so slowly.
Yeah. Like, you had it for a while before you did anything, right?
Yeah. I don't know how long it's been, like,
dude, kind of reaction.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't know how long it's been, like, impairing me necessarily, or all I know is it feels really good now to have it fixed, and like I'm excited as fuck to kind of get out and use my voice again.
I had mine for about 6 months. I had two of them. So I had one kind of in that area you're talking about, like where your pubes are. And then I had another one where I ripped it. So your ball sack goes like this, and then you've got two holes that feed the tubes into your ball sack. So I ripped one of those holes, and then my guts slowly began seeping into my nuts. Yeah. And I was like, you know, like I was feeling it, and I was like, fuck, my nuts are always hurting. Like, what is going on? And this is, you know, I'm touring that whole cycle, so I'm feeling it. And then by the time we get to that tour with you guys, I'm like, I'm getting off stage, and I'm like, I got to lay down flat for like a half an hour just so I can feel it kind of suck back in. Like, it was just getting super fucking weird.
I don't know how you do it. Like,
and I got hammered one night when I wrestled my 300-pound merch guy, and fucking he like slammed me. And when he slammed me, I kind of felt like my nuts, and I was like, ooh, that didn't feel good. And the next day I woke up, I was like, fucking, it's over. Like, I don't even know what's going on. I went and looked at my nuts, and I've got like three nuts because my middle nut is like my guts going into my fucking ball sack. And I was like, I took a picture of it because I was like, what? I'm never going to see this again. I got to take a picture of this shit.
Fucking E.T., man. Eddie Torres, the extra testicle, man.
Right. So I was like,
wow, that's dark, dude. Like, I can't believe that you endured that and just jumped back on stage and just kept ruling it, man. Like, you do so many vocals that like go from like low to high, like in one sweep too. That kind of like power up thing that you do all the time. Like,
it was, I mean, it was a lot of pain pills. I gotta say, man, I brought that up though because because Adam would always come in, your drummer would always come in and check on me, like, dude, like, it's fucking crazy what you're doing. And I'm like,
it is, man. Yeah, I've thought about it a lot, you know, dealing with this hernia and stuff, and definitely planned on bringing it up today.
The fucking bus broke down. We got fucking, you know, fucking the House of Blues wouldn't let us play because we were banned from there. Like, it was just so many fucking crazy things on that tour.
It's just for us, it was like, you know, we're the opening band, so we're back to like the hurry up and wait guys,
right?
You know what I mean? Like, kind of standing by to push the cabs and stuff. And like, also, like, there wasn't always a place for us, you know, like a backstage room. So we had to improvise sometimes. Sometimes we were drinking in the back of like maybe one of your trucks or something. Like, I don't know. Like, there was a lot of that. So in a way, it was kind of a good tour to jump a new guy into, you know what I mean? Because it was hard. It wasn't like as padded as like when we're headlining and, you know, calling all the shots and stuff.
Did you go to the, I remember, I was just remembering this now. I remember Brian and I think it was you. We all went to Rush. One of them, it was like near the end of the tour.
Oh, no, I didn't go to Rush.
Okay, but, gotcha.
Yeah, that's cool though. I've seen Rush before.
Yeah.
But I remember that now.
Yeah, I think they were playing right next door, and I had a buddy who was working for them. So I was like, hey, can you, you know, he just gave me a bunch of tickets, and I was like,
oh, that's rad.
Does anybody want to go to Rush? Like, they're fucking like across the street. It was crazy. It was awesome.
Yeah, last time I went to Rush, I took my ex-girlfriend, and she got so mad that they didn't play any songs she wanted that she like cried epically.
Oh no. She must have really liked a certain era.
Yeah, No Bite or the Snow Dog. That was like the fucking, that was it.
They didn't play enough 2112. Not enough hemispheres. You know, I was gonna say, I'm trying to remember the first time, I think the first time I met you, and if it wasn't the first time that I met you, it's the first time I remember hanging out with you, was you guys were opening for Cannibal. We had a day off in Cleveland, and then we were playing the next day, and then you and Cannibal were there. I think you had Shannon in the band, who I had known through somebody else, maybe through all that remains. I can't remember why I knew him, but I knew him somehow. But we ended up hanging out, raging show. I remember Steve-O was there, Steve-O from Jackass.
Right, right. And then after that, a lot of us went to the Municipal Way show.
Yes,
like,
we went to, we fucking, you and I, that's where I remember hanging out with you, was just you and I raging.
Oh, dude.
Oh my God.
I threw up right on the bar top there. I've done that a few times, but definitely it was like, the ringworm stinger, Human Furnace, bought me a shot. And I was like, yo, this is awesome. I love ringworm. Got to be cool right now. Glug, 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 barf all over the place. I was like, I barfed my way out the front door, you know? Like,
that's fucking rad. You were not barfing when we were hanging out for the
good moment. Good good.
We were buying. I don't know if you remember this, but we carried a bunch of shots up on stage to municipal waste.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Bought a bunch of shots and we like brought the tray up like here. They're like, oh,
yeah, fuck. Yeah. That was a fun ass show right there, man. It was. A good one.
You guys. What's that?
Guys are ridiculous, man.
It was fucking awesome. Tiny little club, just fucking raging.
I feel like we talked about Skeleton Witch maybe at that show.
We talked about Skeleton Witch, and we talked about, you turned me on to a band called Oceans?
The Ocean.
Yeah, The Ocean.
Right, the Metal Blade band, kind of, yeah, in that like Neurosis vein.
And very, there was another cool band that like ended up being like a big influence on the next record that we did. I want to say that was, I don't even remember what album.
Scarlet? I know Scarlet. We talked about Scarlet.
Yes, we talked about Scarlet. Yes, that
was cool, dude.
Song, that fucking opening song of that record just blew my mind, dude. I just...
Dude, those guys never had any luck, man. They never took off. We met them through doing a tour. Like, they opened, a tour, and we were second of four. And then Every Time I Die and As I Lay Dying were flip-flopping, headlining. That was one of our first big tours where we went, you know, all across the nation and stuff. And yeah, I just thought they were a cool band. Somewhere it's like a little bit of Nine Inch Nails, a little bit of Refused, like just a cool kind of cocktail of things. And just great production, you know? So we ended up going to record with Scarlet basically on the second record in Richmond, which
you
was
went
fun.
To record with them?
Yeah. They recorded themselves pretty much. They're like, you know, produced and that kind of thing. So yeah, we went out to Richmond. We like crashed on somebody's couch the whole time. And, you know, we were drinking cans of Steel Reserve. Like, it was like when we had no money and stuff. And it was great. It was a great time. I think that was probably the most fun that we had making a record. I think that we might have been a little bit high on our own shit after the popularity of the first record. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And I just remember being kind of carefree and just, I don't know, man, it was a good time for sure.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like a great time. And that's, you know, that's like, you guys came out and like, it was like fucking people loved your band and it's fucking awesome. Like, why not be high on it for a while? Like, it's fucking,
yeah, it was,
things
it was,
came your way.
Dude, it was amazing, man. You know, it was something we never could have predicted. And it's still been going in that same trajectory, man. Like, it's just been this giant snowball for all this time. And, you know, I think a lot of it is just making the right decisions. You know, we've never claimed to be the most original band in the world or anything. You know, we're not reinventing the wheel here. You know, it's definitely a cocktail of all different corners of metal, you know, classic mostly. But yeah, I think it's just been a lot of right decisions, you know, kind of like we said, putting your pride aside and touring with all different kinds of bands in the spectrum, whatever your fans like, you know, different kinds of fans like different kinds of things. And we try to appeal to all of them, you know. So, you know, death metal tours are more my steez personally, you know what I mean? But like, we'll go and do Warped Tour. Like, why not? If they'll have us and, you know, we get to shove death metal up a bunch of kids' asses for the first time every afternoon, like, why not? You know what I mean? We went to Warped Tour as Black Dahlia Murder. We didn't change what we did. You know, we got up there and shredded and swore at the crowd and, you know what I mean? Like, the usual stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, we've gotten flack for doing some kind of shit like that. But, like, I don't want to have too much pride to put my own kind of glass ceiling on top of what this band can do. You know what I mean? Like, I want to just kind of see it through and you know, like, those, when we got put on Ozzfest for the second record, that was a massive, massive turning point and a big revelation. You know, like I said, I'd never thought we were not commercial enough, I guess, but like not like accessible enough to be on a big like festival kind of thing like that. You know what I mean? And that was before you'd see Cannibal Corpse on Mayhem and stuff like that, right, and right. Sounds of the Underground. It was just before all those kind of popped off and we'd get a piece of those as well. But yeah, I remember like
Ozzfest was always good for having like Second Stage, Neurosis, Vision of Disorder, right. You know, like,
our particular year was really great for us in that a lot of our influences were on it. You know, we had Arch Enemy on there, In Flames, The Haunted,
oh, rad.
Shadows Fall,
stuff.
Like, yeah, like all the shit we looked up to, hardcore, soil work. And, you know, so we got to meet the bands and hang out with the bands. Which was
the Mike Schleiber, was the Mike, I'm fucking so
no darkest hour. No darkest hour.
Okay, Jesus Christ.
Nah, no darkest hour. But
Claybon's name before the band for fucking
right. Yeah, that's how it is, man. but yeah, you know, that was a hell of an experience. And then with that, all of a sudden,
Those are all side stage bands, right? Like all everybody.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. They were all on the side stage.
Yeah. You guys must have just been on cloud nine, right?
We were. And all of a sudden we were in magazines. You know what I mean? We were next to As Lay Dying and Unearth, who were more of a metalcore thing, but I didn't care. Like, put us next to them. You know what I mean? Like, get us seen, get our faces out there. And yeah, I feel like we've been
Who's the headliners that year?
It was the Maiden, Black Sabbath, Tug of War, baby.
Oh,
you know,
shit. So the one Trivium was on that too, right?
Yep, Trivium was on that Killswitch. As well.
I went. I saw that in
Killswitch.
LA. Yeah, I saw that in LA. I must have seen you guys then.
Yeah, see, that was a banger, man. It was a banger. Well, okay. There was a chance we could have been playing at like 8 a.m. or something on the day that you know right. what I mean. Right. The kind of rotating schedule there was interesting.
Yeah, there was only a couple of bands that had like that firm slot, right?
Right, slot. Yeah, there was like different tiers of rotation kind of.
Okay.
And yeah, some days, you know, you'd get that first slot, dude. And sometimes they wouldn't let people in at a, you know, they'd be kind of choked up at security or whatever. And we'd be starting the second song, and there's nobody there yet, literally.
Oh my God.
We had like the other bands go down and mosh for us one time. I remember, you know, they were just trying to raise our spirits a little bit.
Because like, it's fucking 9 in the morning. You're like, I'm hungover. Fucking.
Yeah. Like, I
no one should be playing death metal this early.
I smelled the table with Mastodon, you know. Right. I'm not feeling great today. But yeah, it was eye opening, man, to like the potential of this band and like the kind of crossover potential, you know what I mean? And then we started to run with it after that, I think, you know what I mean? Diversify a bit more with the tour lineups. And like at first it was metalcore that was popping off. So we kind of rode that wave and we got kind of linked with that a lot, which I never personally loved, but what can you do? You know, and then deathcore kind of popped off and we had some similarities with that, you know, the high and low vocals and stuff like that. So we got lumped with that and I didn't care for that either, really. But looking back now, it was advantageous to be kind of lumped with both situations. You know, they were both very popular and they helped kind of perpetuate this thing. And when I look out in the crowd at a Black Dahlia murder show, I see every fucking walk of the underground from punk to metal. And kind of everything in between.
Hardcore.
And I like that about it. I like the diversity. You know, like we are also punk kids. We always have been, you know, like most people that have been through this band are also, you know, they came up on hardcore kind of parallel to metal, you know, and I did too. And the early BDM shows we were playing alongside like Throwdown and Bane and all these like really exciting live bands, and it forced us to kind of look at ourselves and be like, yo, I know we're playing like more complex shit here, but we got to like try to be exciting on stage. And like seeing the way that hardcore like broke down that fourth wall, you know, so like I'm the guy that'll like stick my mic in people's mouths and stuff to sing, and like that's not a super death metal move to do, you
not
know
at all
I mean?
Yeah,
it's definitely more of a hardcore thing, but like I just love that kind of melee when there's no security and you're trusting the crowd and people can crowd surf, people can come up on stage, you can get the mic into their face. And like, that's the ideal show for me. So like, I like when we're playing mid-sized venues, you know what I mean? Or like when we're playing shows where it has that kind of setting, you know what I mean? There's no giant barrier for people to jump over, you know, like I like a punk rock show, you know, and I like when it can kind of creep into our world there. You know, I feel like ideally, you know, we'd be close enough to the crowd to like interact in that way. You know what I mean? And that's just a takeaway from coming up in hardcore and, you know, like not looking at yourselves as like being on a pedestal, but like being a man of the people, you know what I mean? And like being an equal and, you know, and we've always kind of carried ourselves like that too as a band. I think that's also helped keep this thing going, is like being so fan forward being the kind of handshaking baby kissers that we are. And, you know, just showing.
If you're sitting at the merch booth, like after the show or during the show, like that's fucking amazing.
It definitely gets you know, harder as years go on and the band gets more popular. You and definitely put yourself out there for more punishment doing that kind of thing.
For sure. I don't do that anymore.
but I get it, dude. I totally get it, you know? Yeah. And, but it has been a big thing that's helped this band, you know, like they see our personality. You know, like we've never, like the music has always been serious and like done completely dead serious, you know, but as we kind of went through the years, it seemed like the more personality we let hang out on stage, in videos, in photos, and otherwise, the more people liked it, the more we stood out. Like I remember when we turned in the photos for Miasma, the second album, and we got like dudes like drinking beers, there's a guy laughing, there's somebody punching another guy in the face and like he's acting like he got hurt, and the label was like, what are these? this is us, and now you see that all the time. You see people like doing funny stuff, you know, acting like they're partying, blah blah blah.
At the time though, it might have been like needs to be in a forest, serious,
right. Exactly, like so like they had like trepidation about it. And you know, the video, like you almost can't make a good metal video. Like the themes and stuff you need to be like, you'd have to have Madonna money to make a good metal video that like you could have castles and horse riders and all that shit, that all the metal tropes that you want.
Right.
You know, like I remember the first like handful of videos we made, I had my sights set so high, and then seeing them back, I was crushed. I hated them. I was so fucking mortified. I was like, all right, I guess put them out. I mean, they still helped us, you know what I mean? But they definitely looked like a high school Spanish video.
I think the first time I got turned on to you guys was your like kind of documentary party video, you know, I fool them all.
That,
I can't remember what
that was huge too. That was,
I mean, like touring. The whole thing starting off with like bong rips and fucking, I was like, fuck, sweet, like look at these maniacs,
you know? Yeah, for sure. And like that kind of cemented our reputation as being this maniac party band. But really,
I saw that before I heard your band. That's how powerful that video was. That was my introduction to Black Dahlia Murder.
It did that for people, you know. It was kind of passed around like the way that the Pantera home videos were, and that was kind of our hope too, you know, like just show them who we are, show them how much we love to do this. And they caught us at that perfect moment. You know, we were just headlining the first time headlining Summer Slaughter over like Vader, Cataclysm, Psycroptic, Aborted, Whitechapel, Despised Icon, just like the most stacked bill you can think of that year. You know, and we were at the top of it and things were popping off for our third record, Nocturnal. And it was, you know, we were in a bus. It was like a dream, dude. It was like the dream was becoming realized and you can just see it on our faces, you know. And I'm really glad that that moment is kind of encapsulated in time like that, you know.
Yeah.
But now people think that I can still drink like that. You know what I mean?
That you're whipping at bong ripping every minute of the day.
right. You know, but I don't know, like having the reputation of a party band has been fun. You know what I mean, too.
It can come and bite you in the ass though, right? Like,
oh, it can.
Municipal Waste was telling me we did some shows with them and they were like, I'm so sick of partying.
Oh, I bet they have to show up. You know what I mean? And like Cannabis Corpse, like imagine like I just don't want to do dabs today, guys.
Can we wait a couple hours? No.
But you know, like, man, what was I gonna say? The Majesty thing, like putting that DVD out, it did come to bite us in the ass eventually, because when we changed members, people were so attached,
right,
to those certain members because they had been watching this, like, you know, like almost comedy routine from them. You know what I mean? Like, because like it was very humor laced and very funny. And so yeah, there was some kind of pushback when we lost Shannon, when we lost Bart and John, you know. So it's a double-edged sword, man. You give them a view into your world, but there's no guarantee it's going to be all the same people forever, you know what I mean? Like you know better than anybody, you know what I mean?
Right.
And
Yeah,
that's just something.
I'm coming up on my 30-year anniversary here.
Yeah, man, and you know we've had all.
I'm amazed that you have the same amount of records that I do, and like 2/3 of the time, I was like, "Fuck."
You know, it's kind of just like what we felt was necessary. Kind of looking at how disposable music has become to people, like how much access they have to music now. It's just like you can hear a million things in a day if you want. And it just seemed like it was appropriate for the average fan's attention span. You know what I mean? To like come back with a new record, new artwork to be excited about, new merch themed after it, you know, like just kind of restoking the flames is kind of how we look at it. And, you know, like our biggest models of like what to follow has always been Cannibal Corpse, because they are just like stalwarts. They've endured so many different trends. And, you know, like when I first started seeing them, it was just after death metal's heyday, you know, like the early wave of the 90s. So like I started coming into shows like 95, 96, you know, and like I saw
like George.
No, okay. Like George's first tour, probably.
Okay.
You know, like at that time, you know, we had nu metal coming up and death metal was kind of like going into a lull, mm-hmm. you know, like it became oversaturated. It had its moment, you know, like in the early 90s, you had fucking Obituary selling 200,000 copies of, of
an album. Deicide the same.
Yeah.
Morbid like, Angel on MTV, on MTV with sick fucking videos for.
Right. Right. You know, you had like, Columbia kind of like biting a little bit of the Earache catalog to put out on a
putting
major.
Out Entombed. Yeah, they were putting out
Entombed. Yeah, that was crazy times. And then like, you know, it had to kind of wane.
I think
you know what I mean?
Even Napalm Death came out through Columbia. Like that.
Right, right. Crazy. Yeah. That's right. And so, you know, like metal is always gonna kind of I think really underground stuff is always gonna kind of wax and wane in popularity, you know. But like now it's like this kind of death metal renaissance. It feels like there's so many young people getting into death metal and specifically old school death metal, you know, where it's not just about playing as fast as you can, but like actually creating a sort of horror movie-esque atmosphere, you know? And I think that's what we need to happen for death metal to kind of survive and thrive, you know, is kind of like, it needs to go in all directions. You know, there needs to be the fast tech bands that are super slick, and the shit that sounds like the Autopsy demo.
Yeah, exactly.
Shit that's loose and like dirty and everything in between, man. And I love every fucking bit of it, you know? So like, I'm still a kid.
You're saying that Cannibal is an influence though, in the sense that like they've been, you know, they super consistent with the artwork. Like the vibe is, I mean, it's always like, you know what you're getting.
They've never strayed. Like you could even say, you could say that Slayer strayed. Like people use Slayer as this kind of example, but Slayer went pretty nu metal, you know, at times.
Heck yeah, they did.
And
that Pain of Mind song or Stain of Mind.
Right. Oh, like, yeah, dude, that whole record. That, man, like whoa, that
culture.
That was a heartbreaker for me as a kid for sure. But like, you know, people cite Slayer for doing that, but they really didn't stay the course entirely. You know what I mean? But Cannibal is just tried and true Cannibal. They've never fucking delved away, but they care. They're not just like shitting these records out. Like, they still care. They still push themselves to write better songs.
Yeah. It's pretty amazing that they've managed to, like, you know, because they've had a lot of lineup changes and a lot of guitar player changes where the songwriting could have gone all over the place. And, you know, they've managed to just keep that fucking that vibe going, you know, gotten more technical, but like, you know.
Right. Yeah, for sure. You know, and they've kept it like so it sounds like Cannibal. You know, it's them every time from the first notes. And that's what we wanted. We thought not just now and not just here in the States, but we thought globally, and we thought about longevity. You know, we thought about being here on a permanent basis and what that would entail. You know what I mean? And so like we've seen, you know, like we're talking about the rise, like metalcore's big wave there, and then deathcore. Like those are two trends that we kind of endured and wrote out in a little way, you know, and were advantageous to us. And you know, like there could be a time in the future where metal, you know, starts to wane in popularity again, and it's not as readily available in every high school as it is right now. You know what I mean? Like, because in 99 when I was graduating, you know, I was like one of two death metal kids at the school. You know what I mean? Like, And I imagine things are a lot different right now. You know, it feels like it. It seems like there's so much youthfulness and so much youth energy in metal right now. And it's exciting for an old guy, you
Yeah.
know?
I mean, you've already rode two trends, which is crazy to think about. You know what I mean?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Like it was something that we wanted to be able to do. We wanted to be able to like endure and not just be like a flash in the pan, you know what I mean? And there's so many bands that we came up alongside that just didn't have the same luck as we did, or didn't have the same staying
Drive, or
power,
who
you
knows?
know,
Yeah.
or who knows, you know, there's it's hard to really pinpoint like where things went wrong. A lot of the bands like the Red Cord, for example, I fucking loved them, and like we looked up to them massively, and they took us on our second tour ever, and they just didn't have that same luck, man. They didn't have the same, I don't know where it went wrong or what happened, but you know, I thought they deserved the world, you know.
Yeah.
And
Great guys, man.
yeah, for sure, hilarious
And
band.
I want to say like Gus Eye or I can't
Guy.
gun eye gun
Gunface.
gun face.
Gunface was the guitar player and Guy was
Oh
the
my
singer.
God. And what was the
You
guitar? What was the
combined
bass
both
player's
guys.
name? The bass player's name.
Greg.
Oh my God. Those
God, he's
fucking two
hilarious,
dudes
dude.
were so f I've never laughed that hard on tour ever.
I don't
Like
think
they
I
would just
have
come on the
either.
bus and fucking just rip, and like it would just
Yeah,
be on
they're
and
insane.
so fucking funny,
Yeah,
man.
those two together are ridiculous.
Yeah.
I still talk to Gunface every once in a while. You know, he's like doing more studio stuff now. He's playing in Wear Your Wounds with Jacob from Converge.
Okay.
And yeah, he's got a lot of stuff going on creatively and shit. And you know, we tour with Red Cord probably 5 times, you know, like a lot. They were like our brother band for a while there. And
Right.
yeah, we looked up to him, man. The very first time we played with them, we were just a local band in Michigan, and they were so fucking disgusting live that we had a band meeting at the show. We're like, did you see that? She's like, we're not doing that. Did you notice? Like, we got to get back to the drawing board because holy
You know what
fuck.
though? Like, I think that's the one thing that, like, when you were saying how your guy never played with anybody, like, those are the moments to me that I think that, like, are so important as a band coming up where, you know, you're playing with a hardcore band or you're playing with a thrash metal band, you're playing, like, you're gonna learn something. And then you play with a hardcore band, you're like, holy f like, I gotta fucking step this up. Like, we gotta fucking, you know, it's not about technicality and it's not about a ripping solo. It's just about fucking beating shit down and fucking making people lose their mind. And those little things, you know, even if you suck in front of that show, like you learn, you take something away from that, you know, like something in
Right.
there kind of, you know, your DNA gets rearranged and you're like, okay, like now I know what to do, you know.
Oh,
And
for
that's, I
sure.
think that's
Like
important. And I see that
I
in your guys.
of
Like I, when you were saying that, I was like, yeah, totally. You know, when
Dude,
we were
I
coming up, like it was the same thing. Like there was only hardcore bands and death metal bands. Like thrash was basically dead. And like, we didn't know where to go. So we were just like, all right, we'll play with a funk band. We'll play with a hardcore band. We'll play with, you know, so we're playing with Rancid. We're playing with Possessed. We're playing with, you know, shit like that.
Yeah,
So,
that's cool, man. You try
yeah.
a bit of everything and see what sticks. And you know, there's people that like all different kinds of shit. I still love punk as much as I always have. You know what I mean? Like, I
Yeah.
still love hardcore. There's so many people that want you to be cut and dry, you know, like fit into a certain category, and like they'll put their blinders on to everything else. You know what I mean? Like, that's so like I've been that guy too at certain ages. You know what I mean? Like first
Oh.
discovering death metal. Like being too cool for the Big Four, too cool for Pantera and Sepultura, all of a sudden, you know what I mean? Just like being a typical keyboard
Right.
jockey incel type person,
Only
you
death
know?
metal, only the demo.
Yeah,
Only
only
the demo.
demo, bro. You know, just like, but you know, like I love everything, man. Like the older I get, the more music I like. And I it doesn't matter what kind of show I'm seeing, what kind of concert, like I take something away for our band, you know, like either what to do or what not to do. You can learn plenty about what not to do from watching bands too, you know what I mean? Like that's very
Totally.
educational too, you
I'm
know,
sure you've
so
seen that singer who like would talk to the crowd and you'd just be like, okay, like fucking
oh,
stop.
for
Just don't
sure.
do that anymore.
Yeah.
Don't, you know, like just play a song. You're bumming everyone out.
For sure. Yeah, dude, I'm gonna try not to be that guy in this next tour.
Right.
You know, because like of course everyone's gonna want to give their fucking COVID speech and like, you know what I mean? But like I don't want to like punish the fuck out of everybody. I'm gonna try to be
People are
conservative
just gonna,
here.
people just want
Also,
to, they want to escape from it for, you
yeah,
know,
I think I'm
the
gonna
hour that they're watching.
probably cry for the first 10 shows because I'm gonna be so fucking happy and
Right.
emotional. It's going to be me and old man Brian up there just crying our eyes out. Like, hey, guys.
We're back on stage, man.
I missed you. Slap me in the bare back, man. Come on. I even miss that guy. I miss the, like, roofer dude that slaps you on the bare back after the show with an open hand. Great job, man.
Can you do, like, imitations of, I mean, you've been in a band with Brian now for 20 years now. Can you do the ultimate Brian voice imitation? Like,
no, man, I don't know if I can.
No,
no, that's more like Alan is like he can impersonate any one or thing. Like, we've
okay.
He can play Painkiller on drums while singing Painkiller, like exactly
wow.
how it sounds. Like,
that's
he's
fucking rad.
A mutant. I've been like pushing him to like, you know, make a video of that somehow and get it out there, you know.
Fuck
for
yeah.
like forever.
Would love to,
but,
dude, that'd be fucking that's great pandemic content right there.
Yeah, dude, he'd hit ball drop
it'll
right
get
there.
Picked, that shit will get picked up everywhere.
But yeah, I mean, Brian is
don't do a COVID speech. Like, just right, be like, you know, happy right. to see you again.
We're
know?
Back. Yeah. Happy to be back. Slap me on the back.
Right.
Spill your stale beer on me.
I hear you. I might cry the first couple of shows too, just like, fuck,
dude. Like, I don't know, you know, like, I there's it's been so surreal to be kind of just cut off from all this, you know what I mean? Like, it was like hitting a wall at 1,000 miles per hour for us, because we've never said no, we've never stopped, we've never willingly been like, all right, let's take a vacation. Like, that's not in our vocabulary. To be in Black Dahlia Murder means you're going to do every opportunity that arises. Like, to be in this band, you don't get to say like, oh, dude, I can't because I'm going on vacation then, you know, like, nope.
Right.
That's not it. That's not how it works. It's yeah. like complete sacrifice, complete like devotion to it, you know? And like, I think that's where we've seen these member changes is like, just the grueling nature of how much we tour and how unglamorous a lot of it is. And
it's how you're living. It's how you're
for sure. And we're not the band to like get a zillion texts, you know, like we're kind of like keep it conservative. And you know, we're the guys that are like, hey, thanks, good night. And we turn around and start unplugging our shit on stage and wheeling it off. You know, just like it takes humility to be in this band, and we want to, you know, come home with more money. So we're not going to be stupid and just like pay for the illusion, you know? Right. So yeah, it's us pushing cabs, you know, we keep it very close to the chest. The guys tech their own guitars. We don't have a fucking drum tech, all these like luxuries that like, you know, a lot of big bands
I
spring
for. Yeah.
Right. Exactly. It's just to kind of keep the overhead low.
Yeah.
So we can come home with money. Okay. And
dude, the
like,
overhead for touring is fucking crazy. You know, I love that you talk, you're pretty open with it. I've, you know, watched a couple podcasts and, you know, you're very open with it, which I always very impressed with, because, you know, a lot of bands don't talk about, like, it fucking costs a lot of money, man. Like, you know, people think you go on a US tour and you're not coming home with fucking, you know, no one's going and buying a car and houses and shit. Like,
the moment you sign up for the bus period is like a massive blow to what you'll be walking.
It's $800
with, you know,
in gas a day.
Right. So, you know, we kind of keep it very conservative. We always have. And we took that from hardcore too. You know, like, you see Converge just totally destroy a place and wheel their calves back into the fucking trailer and jump in the van. And that's Converge life. You know, there's sacrifice to it. There's, you know, like, it's about love. It's, you know, like, this whole, it's a labor of love, you know, like, we wouldn't be doing this if we didn't love it. So to have bandmates that we trust and that we're friends with is like the most important thing overall. Like, we would never have a hired gun. We would never have distrust about money in the band. Like, we split everything five ways.
Yeah.
Just like,
I heard you
to
say
motivate
that.
Everybody to like, we're all equals here. And it's fucking hard, dude. You know, like, I wouldn't want anybody in our band doing what we're doing for less reward than what I'm getting myself. Like, it's that hard. You know what I mean? Like, it's not fun and games. It's a lot of camping. It's a lot of mental strain. Like, people don't realize when they come up to you and talk to you on tour, you're never at 100%.
Never.
Never. You're never actually are in the mind, like, all I want to do right now is walk up and just rip this show. You know what I mean? Like, you're tired, you didn't sleep, you bounce around your bunk like a fucking pinball.
Yeah.
For
the, you know, five hours you were driving, then finally you parked, and then, you know, you got like two or three hours of sleep while it was parked finally a little bit.
Right. Yeah. That's me. I can never sleep while any of it's moving, dude. You know, and the bandwagon was a special kind of torture in that regard. That,
I've never seen one, but I've heard that those are just like a nightmare of all nightmares.
They're great when you're not moving, you know, you have like a lot of the facilities that a bus has, you know, right. Which is great, but
it's like a tank on the road.
Yeah, dude. It's like seriously like having square wheels on the bus. You know what I mean? So like, yeah, people don't know what you go through. They don't know that it's a uphill battle the entire tour. You know what I mean? Like, it is fun. It's awesome. It's rewarding, but it's not without a lot of sacrifice and a lot of discomfort, you know?
For sure. I did the van tours and all that teching for myself for the first 7 years. And then after that, I was like, I can't do this anymore. Like, I'm just, you know, when Machine Head started touring, we're like, now we're touring for 20 months straight, 22 months, 25 months. I'm like, I can't do this. Like,
yeah, that's insane. Like the most gnarly years we had, we did like 10 months,
mm-hmm.
which is a lot. You know what I mean? Like we would do
a ton.
We would have like four US tours just kind of butted up against each other because there was no demand for us yet. You know, we couldn't like create demand for something that nobody wanted yet. We had to like hit new people, you know? So
yeah.
Now we can afford to step back. We'll tour like 6 months a year pretty much now.
Yeah.
And you know, that's, you know, we have enough of a reputation to where people are anticipating the next tour. You know, it's like, mm-hmm. we can kind of create that anticipation where, but yeah, dude, like touring it's hard, man. People think it's just like this, you're laying backstage being fed grapes by big tittied women and stuff. And it's just, it's nothing like that. You know what I mean?
Occasionally like that.
Occasionally, like, and choosing death metal as your girl getting avenue is not really, I wouldn't recommend it to any aspiring musicians out there.
Hey, you had a super hot girl with you the night that we were in Cleveland. That was, you had like a super cute girl.
Hey man.
She was like,
sometimes it happens.
You're like, it works sometimes.
But like, you know, if that's your end game here, if you're here for chicks, like go play pop punk, dude.
Right.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, hey, it's going to be 100 times easier. Like another thing is like when I see a nice band playing, a nice band is anything outside of metal to me. You know what I mean? Like, so I get jealous. I'm like, wow, they're just up there playing and like, it doesn't hurt. And like, they're smiling and people are dancing. Yeah. And like
this,
you know,
is
like,
so weird.
It is weird. And like, I kind of feel like, would I know if they were having a good time if they weren't like punching each other in the head? Or like, you know, like, but the idea of just getting up there and playing this relaxing music and just being in the pocket and like grooving out in your Hawaiian shirt or whatever,
right?
Like, it's weird, but it kind of sounds awesome too, because what we do in Black Dahlia is so labor intensive musically. And so exhausting, you know, at the end of a set, you know, we'll play for an hour and 15 minutes, typically when we're headlining 18 songs at, you know, 3 minutes a piece and 10,000 snare hits a piece.
Yeah.
It's like a barrage, dude. And at the end of it, there's nothing left. You know what I mean? Like, it's kind of like, I don't know, like Rollins and Black Flag was like a super, super huge influence on me for wanting to get out and tour and kind of seeing the reality of DIY and, you know, applying that to like what we were doing in our early bands and stuff. And, you know, their philosophy was like to literally get up there and just play as fucking hard as you possibly can and destroy yourself with the music is kind of what they called it, you know? And that's just kind of how the kind of bit of punk that we took to Black Dahlia Murder, you know what I mean? To like really just rage out and go off and just put everything you fucking have into it. So yeah, you know, I get a little jealous that I see these bands up there that can come off and like, oh yeah, I got a little sweaty around the armpit.
You're talking like a jam band.
Yeah, sure. Or like all kinds of shit, you know, like, and I love all kinds of music, you know, like I think being in a funk band would be so much fucking fun. Like every night is a fucking party.
Yes.
And, you know, it'd be awesome. You know, it's a whole different walk of life than what we do in Black Dahlia.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that kind of like, all right, time to destroy yourself. Let's fucking, let's get crazy up here. You know, it's just been kind of how we always applied it. And, yeah, we sometimes you'll see a metal band and they're just like standing there looking at the guitars, and the way they play is just very, it's not hard. You know, they're not like really digging in. It's just like, it's not exciting. You know what I mean? Like there's some metal bands that just are too,
there needs to be some dirt in there.
Yeah, there's got to be some excitement.
Like, I always say, like, when I see a singer, like I want to look at him and be like, the motherfucker's got problems. I like it.
Yo, for like, sure, for sure.
That's what I want.
Oh man, the early tours, we would be up there setting up our shit, and people thought we were our own crew. You know, they thought that we were gonna walk off on stage, and then some cool people were gonna come up and start playing the instruments. You know?
So you guys don't do. You don't even do like put the hoodies up and then take the hoodies off.
No, not really, man. I think the most resistance we ever were met with was when we did King Diamond and Nile and Behemoth.
Okay.
You know, we're coming out there as like, you know, this new wave of short-haired extreme metal bands was just getting footing, and you know, right, we're playing in front of a very classically leather-clad metal kind of crowd, and there were people like hurling insults and fucking anything they could do, man. There was people that wanted to physically fight me.
Oh shit.
Just because we're there. You know what I mean? Like I remember like stepping off the barrier at a point and just like putting my feet on a person's shoulders, you know, just like collapsing them basically. Mm-hmm. And like just, yeah, there was a lot of confrontation, a lot of, but also that was exciting too. It was exciting to kind of be like this middle finger, you know what I mean? Like to kind of like upset people and like stir up their perception of what
that's really
be
weird.
Happening
really
at a King Diamond show.
Yeah. You know, what's so funny about that is the first time I saw Merciful Fate, I don't know if you know, like back in the day, Merciful Fate used to be like really hated. Like people would just be like, and King Diamond would be like, fuck you. Like, fuck. I saw them support Motorhead, and like
that.
The fucking half the crowd
that
turned against him. Like they were spitting on him, and fucking like it was this really like kind of what you're talking about, in like this really like fuck you, like kind of a vibe. And he like really played it up. He was like, no, fuck you. Like he'd get in people's face and throw his fucking mic at people. And you know, it was pretty fucking gnarly. So like to see that go into the opposite where now like, oh yeah, we don't like you because you're this other way, like it's just that's
well yeah crazy. it wasn't their choice how their right. fans were going to handle the situation, right. You know, and a lot of people liked it, you know, like that was interesting, you know, definitely.
Yeah, we did Suicide Silence, and after that Death Clock tour we did Suicide Silence and Megadeth and people hated Suicide Silence, like just, you know, there's no singing, you know, it's like
right
kind of
right
vibe.
Oh but, yeah, they're like I bet they never saw that coming either. I wouldn't have either. I would have thought it would have worked out. Yeah. And then like us doing Black Label Society, like that was a slight misstep I think on our part. Like we're so far and away from them, like they have like four songs where dude plays piano on stage, right. You know what I mean, right. Like and then we're up there just like, all right, this song's about, you know, fucking ripping a baby out. Let's do this. like people were not ready, man. A lot of people were just like holding their spot up front and just kind of like giving us the doe eyes. And, you know, of course we've experienced that before, but it's been years and years since we kind of went through that, you know.
Did your fan base end up going to that?
Some of them, yeah. And, you know, that was really flattering to like see familiar faces. But, you know, we didn't
overall
expect that everybody was going to come out. And same thing when you go to Warped Tour, you know, like you're thankful for your fans that do show up and put themselves in this world they might not be comfortable in just to see you, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it's an experiment sometimes playing with other genres or like stuff where there's little crossover like that. And sometimes it rules and it goes great. And sometimes it's like, well, we tried, you know.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. That's all you can do.
Pretty much, man.
You know, I wanted to talk to you about I watched your interview with Metal Injection that you did pretty recently. I want to say it was like 3 or 4 months ago, or at least it came out 3 or 4 months ago.
Yes.
And and you know, like you were talking about how you were really struggling during this kind of pandemic period, and you really, really were, and I gotta give you a shout out for being super courageous and really laying it all out there with, you know, your depression, and you were, you know, I think you were talking about some meds, and then you were gonna ketamine therapy and all this stuff. And
I've still been doing that. And
did all that.
Right. And like that interview is kind of a good photograph of exactly where I was. That was the day before I went in to start ketamine therapy, and was probably the lowest point of that whole thing. And I don't think the interview would have been the same if it had been with anyone but Frank. And Frank is someone I love and trust. And like, I kind of, you know, even get to that point where you forget you're being interviewed, you know, with him.
Mm-hmm. Like, it definitely seemed more like a conversation. Yeah.
Right. Sure. You know, like we are that close. We, you know, so, you know, I don't have any regrets about putting that stuff out there. You know, I think it's stuff that so many of us fucking deal with. And like, it's still weighing on me, man. Just the climate of things. Like, it's so hard to just be tunnel visioned on like all this juvenile shit, you know, like heavy metal and all that stuff, like exclusively for me anymore, because the world is just fuck, man. It's just like so fucking depressing. And like, social media is like a fucking doom scroll every day. And, you know, it's just, it's not looking great for humanity, honestly. Like, so I can't like keep my, you know, whatever little bit of innocence I had left, like, it's just got kind of like nuked during this, you know what I mean?
Right.
And, so yeah, it's like, I mean, I don't have any assets. I don't have money in the bank after this. Like, but it also seems like I might not need it. Like, I'm going to be a charred skeleton in 20 years anyway. So at least that takes care of my fucking retirement plan. You know what I mean? But like, I just have that kind of brain where it's hard for me to not dwell on shit. And I have like a thought a minute, dude. Like, I'm so like one of those overthinking type people where like my thoughts are just a constant fucking barrage, man. Like, if I had it my way, I would think a lot less. Right. You know, but like, yeah,
I think that's pretty common with a lot of musicians and artistic types, you know, like,
right. Too much, yeah, they're so much tortured, man. We're tortured, bro. I think it's because we're sensitive. You know what I mean? To be an artist, I think, is to be sensitive.
Right.
And like, you are aware, like, you know what I mean? Like, and you feel like you, so it's just, I think it's just part of it. You know what I mean? I think it's just part of being that artistic person.
And that feeling is what allows you to channel what you channel out that connects with people.
Right. For sure. You know, there's definitely emotional content in what we do. Like, you know, even though it's a death metal song, like I put myself into what I write. I put my, you know, like I love writing for the band. It's a joy for me. You know, it's definitely gotten harder as the band has gotten more successful and there's more pressure and more eyes on us, you know what I mean? And you know, there's two ways to look at it. It's super good to have that kind of anticipation, but it's also intimidating too, you know what I mean, to have like a blank slate for a new record in front of you. And just so many eyes, you know, like you want to keep the success going, and we've had so many like triumphs, you know what I mean? So like, it feels like just the pressure is mounting and mounting as we go, you know. So it's a lot to kind of internalize. And you know, being as hands-on as I am with the band's social media and stuff, like I'm the guy at the end of every fucking social media thing that you see of Black Dahlia Murder.
For all,
you know, it's not some hired gun. There's nobody cleaning up like the stupid racist shit that pops up, or the naysayers or whatever. It's me. You know what I mean? Like I endure every bit of the punishment this band takes.
You don't have like a buddy, like a bit, there's not another band dude or some just like friend who could help you with that to like, hey,
I don't know. Like I don't really want to give up the reins of it, because I think that the fans have been really responsive knowing that it's me on the other end of it. You know what I mean? I feel like that's a big part of why we've done so well, even, is like just my kind of nerd way of being on the computer all the time just really played into this, you know what I mean? And
but do you feel like that negativity that's coming towards the band for whatever reason, does that get to you after a while?
Yes and no. You know, like, I've developed a thick skin over the years, you know what I mean? You kind of have to. Like, if you're becoming popular, there's detractors. You know, if there's no detractors, you're not doing well. Like, pretty much, like, you, unless you got haters, like, you need to up your game, dude. So, you know, like, I've seen every kind of abuse hurled at us. I've seen us called every kind of thing you could possibly imagine. You know, I've stood behind people. Like, we played, we were with Suicide Silence together, co-headlining, and we played in Arizona at Club Red. Next door was Macabre was playing, and Macabre's one of my favorite bands. I love death metal, and I kept like ragging on the crowd. Like, they had the doors open between the shows so you could go back and forth.
Okay.
I kept ragging on the crowd, like, what are you doing over here? Go see Macabre, you know, get over there, fucking death metal legends, you know. And then we go over to the show and I watch Macabre, and I'm standing behind this guy who's just screaming at the top of his lungs, like, how much he hates the Black Dahlia murder and how we're all faggots and all this, you know, all this shit. And I'm like, I'm just standing behind this guy,
right?
You know, like, he doesn't even know who I am. He wouldn't know if he saw me, you know what I mean? But like, and then you have Macabre just straight up says they talk shit about us.
Oh,
like,
wow.
From the stage. Like, I'm like, wow.
You're like, I was just giving you props. Supporting you.
Right. I brought my entire band over here. We all love you. Like, you know, like, so like, I don't know. It never fucking ends. You know what I mean? But like, I don't give a fuck, dude. Whatever.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. It's more than negativity of just the world that's getting to you.
Oh, for sure. Dude. Oh, no, for sure. It's really just, dude, like, shit looks so bleak within like our standard of government, and you know, like, fucking climate change is here, dude. Like, it's fucking here. Like, we can't start addressing it in 20 years, man. Like, it's, we're already too late. Like, if we have any fucking hope, we have to address it now. And like,
oh yeah, my whole area that I'm at right now is just so fucking smoky because the second biggest fire in California history is burning.
Dude, like, the world is
100
just
miles
like,
away.
Oh man, like, we're just being kept so fucking stupid right now by like media, and social media has like compounded it. And yeah, it's really just stripped any hope I had for humanity away. Like we are smart. We are inherently smart. We could be doing things a lot better. But we kind of have to like destroy everything and start anew, I think, like, before it's too fucking late. And I don't think we will, man. So sorry, dude. Like, if that's being negative, man, I think I'm just being a realist here. You know what I'm saying? Like, and it's a lot to put aside in your mind. It's a lot to ignore.
Yeah.
I feel like anymore, you know?
How has I did ketamine with Vision of Disorder back in the 90s.
You know, excellent.
Like horse
excellent.
Tranquilizer. And we were partying with it. So it was like,
and then I remember
passing out up against a mirror and like I couldn't move. at a bar.
I've definitely done it like recreationally beforehand and stuff. Okay. And I had experience with it. It's fun. But when you go like get a ketamine infusion, it's like a very low dose, but it's completely pure. Like the stuff on the street you're going to get like isn't going to be this pure, you know. Right. And it's intravenous. You sit in a chair for like an hour and get this IV drip, and you sit in a chair alone in a room listening to your happy place playlist of like, you know, all the songs that like all these positive songs that keep you in a good mindset.
What's on your happy list playlist?
Man, I got like DeBarge on there,
DeBarge,
Earth, Wind,
nice.
And Fire,
nice.
Mad Funk, Mad Disco stuff.
Okay.
Like that's what I listen to like outside of metal most in recent years.
Okay.
It's kind of like
killer.
Like good time music, man.
Love all that.
Fun too. Music, really rhythmic music where death metal is so clinical and like white people music. You know what I mean? Like it's so like like it doesn't have rhythm like Earth, Wind, and Fire and stuff like
right,
that. You
right.
know what I mean? Like,
oh
so
God.
That kind of thing is so attractive to me.
Mm-hmm.
And, sit there in your chair, you listen to your good time music, and you trip fucking balls for an hour.
Really?
Like,
wow.
You get the trip that you seek when you take mushrooms and you want to, like, kind of like give yourself that mental scrub, you know? Like, it's that kind of trip. Like, it's deeply, it was at times confrontational, where like I literally addressed every fucking moment that like led me to this anxiety in my life. You know what I mean? Like from being bullied to just whatever, you know what I mean? Shit within my family. So there were hard moments of it for sure. And like they call it infusion therapy, but like no one is there talking to you. No one is asking you questions. Like, it's not like you're being interviewed really. There's a
you're getting this at like a doctor's office.
It's a doctor's office for sure. It's a little sketchy feeling when you're there. You know what I mean? Like, it's not, it's still new. You know what I mean? Like, these places are new. Like, they're popping up alongside of like, you have like mushroom therapy places too. And, you know, just like, there's a lot of different avenues being explored and like what, you know, these kind of drugs can do for you.
Yeah.
And basically, like, the bottom line is it's not really about the trip that you're taking while you're there, but the next few days after you come home, your brain is like making these new dendrites, which is like awesome. Like, basically you form a lot of your brain when you're young, and you've like the stuff you endure at that time, like, you carry with you your whole life. You know what I mean? So it's kind of like destroys these synapses, like, of looping thoughts that you may have, like, you know, I suck or whatever, or like, you know, if you think that negative thought enough times, it literally makes a fucking synapse in your brain. Right. So your brain will think it even easier. Like, there's a passage for it, like, specifically for that thought. So going to ketamine was like destroying all of your kind of like looping thoughts and kind of having a blank slate. And, you know, like, it literally is like regenerating your brain. So, you know, I've gone like 8 times now.
Okay.
To go through like the program or whatever is like 6 different times in 2 weeks.
Okay. And 6 now different times in 2 weeks. Wow.
Yeah. And now I just come back on a need to basis, which is like once a month.
Okay.
You know, and it's just like whenever you kind of like start feeling like down or depressed or whatever, it's like, yeah, I'll just go back. And, you know, like, it's been fun, honestly. Like, there's been times where I straight up got up and danced, or like I am listening to DeBarge with my headphones on and clad in my death metal shit with an IV hanging out of my arm, and I'm fucking dancing. You know what I mean? Like, in the doctor's office, they don't know. They know nobody's around.
Right. Right.
You know, but like, it's that like heavenly almost at times, you know, like, it's like, I'm such an uptight person. Like, I'm stuck on
cost. Like,
it's like, pricey. It's pretty pricey. It was like $3,000 to do the entire first cycle of 6 or whatever.
Okay.
And it's like $500 a pop to go back.
Okay.
But, you know, I looked at it like that person you saw at the end of that metal injection interview. If you would have walked up to me on the street and be like, yo, $3,000 to feel how you used to feel, what do you think? I'd be like, here you go, buddy. Yeah. You know what I mean? And, yeah, it's been huge for me, man. I've recommended it a lot to people.
Right on.
People that have PTSD, people that have had really hard home lives. Like, my home life was really fucking good. Like, we had to kind of dig to unearth the kind of things where that would have made me get to this anxious space, where, because there is a preliminary interview with the doctor where, you know, you kind of talk about whatever kind of trauma you may have experienced in your life. And like, that was the kind of difficult part. You know what I mean?
What trauma did you,
I mean, it wasn't like much from family. It was more like bullying in school. And, yeah, it was a lot of that. My family was like really secretive. Like, my parents wanted to get a divorce, and they like got separated a bunch of different times and then got back together and just kind of like held it together until my sister graduated, you know. So like, there was strife within the family, but we never saw it.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, they kept it kind of isolated, you know. But
maybe you sensed it, but
right and you know but Yeah, I mean, like I was even anxious as a kid. Like I remember like my mom like sending me up to the counter at D&C to like pay for like a chocolate bar and like me not wanting to do it and stuff. So like, you know, it started early on, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, like it works for people that have like actual PTSD from whatever situations, you know. People that are like what was I gonna say? Like if you have like God, what's the fucking word? I don't know. I'm having a brain fart here, buddy. But yeah, if you have PTSD,
It
if you're
seems like I bet
depressed,
you
if
feel
you're
like it's worked for you
anxious,
though. Like you feel like
dude,
it's
I
made
do.
you.
I do. I feel like it's given me a bit of a new lease on things. You know, it's helped me lighten up a bit.
Right on.
And yeah, it's something I'm gonna stick with. I want to go back and do it right before I leave for the tour. So I'm like walking on sunshine when I get out there. You know what I
Right.
mean?
Yeah.
But it
Exactly.
just it kind of
Hopefully,
like
it carries through the tour too, because the tour can get
right.
like, you know,
It
by
could get grueling.
week four of the
Right.
tour, you're gonna be like, for
Right.
no reason, just because you're tired and
Oh,
fucking
for
wiped
sure,
out.
for sure. And
Are you
yeah,
gonna
I'll
be
see
par Are you
how.
gonna be partying on the tour? I know you said you'd gotten sober in that interview.
Yeah, and then I already fell off of
Sober-ish.
that a while back,
Did you?
of
Okay.
course. And
So what did you fall off? Like everything?
well,
Like drinking, smoking?
no, I mean like I kept smoking. I had to do something to like have some kind of escape. But honestly, the hangovers during the lockdown were so compounded by like what was happening in the world that like, you know, the first day I would be hungover physically and it would suck, of course, feel gross, feel sick. Second day, I would be anxious as fuck, and it would carry into the third day too. Like just like totally like beating myself up, like feeling tremendous guilt, and like
Feeling guilty
just
that you fell off.
no, not necessarily. Just more like that kind of like you know guilt that you get when you're blacked out. Like
Right.
even though I wasn't blacked out, you know,
Yeah.
like just that kind of like. I just my body responds with so much anxiety now, like when I get hungover. So,
When fucking
like,
hangovers, like they last longer now, right?
oh, for sure, dude. Like I said, dude, 3 days, man, for one fucking
Course.
rager.
Like fuck.
So I don't know what I'm gonna do on the tour because, you know, we have half the band that parties and half that doesn't,
Okay.
and I don't know. You know what I mean? Like, the biggest hurdle for me is getting out there and feeling how I want to feel on stage and feeling like getting through my reservations. You know what I mean? To like be that kind of fun party guy that people are expecting and to say funny things on stage. And like, there's a real pressure as the orator in a band, I think, and to be like that guy. You know what I mean? And so I
Have you
don't.
ever toured sober?
Yes, I
Okay.
have. I did 8 months touring
Trip.
sober. I did Warped Tour all sober, which was a real test of willpower because we just didn't fit in there. You know, like every day I'm walking around with my fingers in my ears because like I hate the music I'm surrounded with. And
Don't want to
you
go
know,
talk to that
like
band. You're like,
right,
I don't want to drink beer
exactly.
with this band.
Oh, exactly. Like, and the lunch line is 3 hours long, and it's all
Oh my
these
God.
bands that like
Fucking
only play Warped Tour. And like act like it's summer camp and stuff, and they're like turning around and talking to me like, "Hi," you know, and I'm like, "God, just fucking kill me already."
You're like, you're way too fucking happy. What's the matter with
Like
you?
I already went through this lunch line in mayhem, and there was like 250 less bands, and it took 20 minutes. So I'm here hating this. You know what I mean? Like. And you know, so it was just like it was so we were so out of our element, and it was so bizarre that like that is a tour where I would have drank
Yeah.
probably more, you know what I mean, to kind of cope with it.
Yeah.
So like yeah, like I don't know what I'm gonna do at this time. You know, I'd love to be able to do the smart thing and just go out there sober, you know, but
But you don't have a
like
problem going out there and like being, you know, Trevor from Black
well,
Dog
I
on
feel like I
stage.
kind of do when I'm sober, you know what I mean? Like it doesn't always come as naturally. Where like I associate playing in the band like with this kind of party element and like we party together before we go up there and
Right.
kind of take it up there, you know what I mean? So like to me that's the complete norm with the band. So like I don't know, I want to be more conservative at least because, you know, I can't be like fucking embalming myself every night, dude. Like, it's hard.
It doesn't affect your voice though, or it just
affects your mind. It does, dude. It does. You know, if I get too hungover where I'm like sleeping with my mouth open, just like sucking AC, you know what I mean? Right. Like through my bus vent or whatever, like right. That's not going to end well.
Yeah. The AC, you know, so like kicks your ass.
Like it's gotten to the point where like, I don't smoke during the day even anymore. Like just trying to keep my voice as good as I can. And, yeah, you know, I'll have to be way more conservative here out there, you know, but like, I don't want to not have fun either is the other thing. You right. know what I mean? Like, I don't know. So
it is that balance, man. It is.
I'm going to see what happens. And it's going to be dangerous to get like thrust right back into it all of a sudden. And it's going to be hard not to go hard in the paint. Yeah. You know what I mean? When we first come back. So that's what I'm going to really have to be conservative about.
I so relate to what you're saying, because it's like, you know, I do the same thing. Like I want to go out and party. Of course I want to go out and fucking rage with everybody, but it's like my fucking throat's going to be shot. I'm going to feel like hell. Like, you know, like,
it's hard. I mean, I'm 40 now. Like I'm getting hungover like for real now, you know, in all caps, you know, like, so like, yeah, it's not the same as being 22 and, you know, being like having a mithril liver, you know what I mean? Like, yes. Yeah.
Well, I hope
so. It remains to be seen, dude. I hope I can, you know, make the right decision, you know, and like kind of be conservative, you know,
you'll be fine. You know, you can get through it. If you can get through that first day, it's always going to be the first day. Cause you know, that's when everybody wants to rage is after the fucking
right, yeah,
first day ragers. Like, I don't know what it is. Like first day, let's get fucking, I'm like, it's the first day. Like, slow your roll, like fucking let's get some sleep, you know? But
yeah, so I'm going to try to ease into it, you know, like,
yeah. I hope your ketamine therapy works. I don't know. I'm a little nervous to try that. You know, like I don't know. I think I'm way too addictive of a personality. Like I've gone through being addicted to meth. I've OD'd on heroin. Like I, you know, even not to say that I didn't do ketamine like well right. into the 90s. But I just, you know, like my mom just passed away and she was like full on pharmaceutical drug addict. And like, I mean,
wow, dude, man, that's 20, terrible.
20 plus fucking drugs a day and then another cocktail of drugs to
dude,
fight
that,
off.
That's happening to so many of the older generations now, man. It's fucking yeah. so sad.
It was just wild to watch your mom go all in on opioids at 70. You know, and
oh yeah, I can't even imagine, dude.
Get off of it, and you know, the doctor. I had this fantasy that she would go into the hospital, and then the doctor would be like, "Okay, she's gonna be off," and then it would be like she would be normal again, and she would be the sober person that I remember as a kid. And it,
right,
the doctor was just like, "We can't take her off this shit. She'll fucking die instantly."
So
much shit now. And so like literally till the day she fucking died, she was just on just this crazy amount of meds. And I think I'm kind of, you know, just seeing what it did to her. Like I'm just super like, whoa, like I don't.
Well, good. You know, like that's the fucking nail in the coffin, you know, like it sounds like you've been through a lot. You've endured a lot. You're on top, man. You can't fucking jeopardize it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And it was just, you know. I would just say to you, you know, be careful. Hope it works out well for you. You know, don't come to rely on it, you know, like.
Oh, no, for sure. I can't even afford to rely on it. There's no way.
I don't got enough money to be a drug addict. I mean, somehow she did. Yeah, she... No.
Oh, yeah, man.
That's great shit, though, man. I'm happy for you, though. I'm happy that that's working. And that's some crazy shit. I'd never heard of that until I listened to that interview. So I was,
you know, yeah, dude, it was even new to me at the time. You know what I mean? But like, I felt so desperate to try something different and unorthodox, you know, like I'm on Prozac, like generic Prozac as it is.
Yeah.
But that just wasn't really cutting it.
And so anymore. You're doing those two together.
Right. Yeah, yeah. Like that. I'm still on it. Like there is talk that you could like taper off of it, which I might do in time. You know what I mean? But, you know, so
it helps you though.
Yeah, so far so good. Yeah, you know, I don't know, like I'd venture to say that there's a lot of anxious people in music that are like keeping a tight lid on it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, I had a Shavo from System of a Down on here, and he was telling me that he was addicted to Xanax for 20 years, you know, that he just got off like 3 or 4 years ago, and that it was like this massive, you know, fucking super emotional.
Oh,
like, being not feeling anything for years and years and years. And then now it's like, oh my God, like too much emotions over everything.
Yeah, dude, for real. Just like being exposed to all your emotions all of a sudden and just like tenfold, you know what I mean? Like,
and
coming
he was saying
back to it.
A lot of anxiety, a lot of just like freaking out. You know, obviously the band had, you know, good amount of success, and then, you know, just exploded.
I can't imagine handling the band really, like, even as our band gets bigger, it gets more stressful, you know what I mean? Like, for sure. So like, yeah, I can't imagine what dudes in like super fucking massive bands go through in that regard. It's got to be a lot. It's got to be a lot.
Yeah.
And yeah, man, I don't know. I'm a normal fucking person. I've got problems, you know? Yeah, I'm definitely in more of a fighting shape to go on the tour now than I was. The person in that interview didn't want to go on this tour. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you were saying that you weren't that stoked about it.
It was just like,
and maybe it was just so far away.
It was dread kind of like getting back into that live situation and being in front of scrutiny, I guess, again. And just like, I don't know, just like going back into the public eye, I guess, after all this time just seemed intimidating. You know what I mean? And like just having those like kind of looping self-defeating thoughts that I had, you know, like what chance did I give myself to like get out there and like do it right? You know what I mean? So
do you train at all before you go out on tour? Like,
I mean, like
cardio or, you know, just,
yeah. I mean, like I've been working out more than I have in the past, you know, like, cause I'm acknowledging my age here and, you know, trying to like be a good front man still, you know what I mean? And, like, age gracefully with the band and, you know, and you know, yeah, like, you know, I'll definitely practice a lot by myself before we go out, you know, like I really miss the era of when we all lived in the same town,
right?
And we could, you know, be like a normal band that practiced twice a week. And
right.
And I miss that camaraderie. I miss like blowing off steam. I miss just like being forced to keep everything in check. You know what I mean?
Right.
So now like we just get together a few days in Michigan before we take off.
That's it. Oh, wow.
And there's, you know, a lot of responsibility for everybody at home to take care of their shit, you know?
Right.
So we can't have any slackers.
When you're singing at home or wherever you're rehearsing, you're like, are you going through like full I'm headbanging and doing the whole thing to like get in shape for a tour?
Well, I'll kind of ease into that, you know what I mean, like as we get closer to the tour. Yeah. But you know, at first it just starts like, you know, singing the songs and then right. kind of like putting them in kind of succession, you know what I mean, and like working, especially after being off for so long and kind of like losing the stomach muscles that you kind of build up from yeah. tensing the entire set, you know. Yeah. Yeah, you know, it's been kind of, I've been conscious about that, like really trying to build my stomach muscles back up. And like, I'm feeling really good. Like, I did a cover for Metal Injection, like an At the Gates cover. And that was like my first song back after, you know, the surgery and kind of healing and stuff. And like, I surprised myself. I was like, wow, I really like how this sounds. I really like how easy it was coming to me. You know what I mean? Like, I felt a renewed, like, excitement to do it and a renewed ability to do it by just having my belly button back in the right place, you know?
The hernia. Yeah. Well, dude, shout out your tour. When's it start? It's going everywhere.
Yeah. Up From the Sewer Tour 2021. It starts next month in Chicago on the 3rd of September. It goes all the way to 10/10. Where it ends in New York at Irving.
Nice.
And it's us headlining, After the Burial, Carnifex, Rivers of Nile, and Undeath. So we got a really good variety of shit there.
Stacked bill,
all kinds of styles coming together. A lot of bands people have been begging us to tour with.
Dude, that most recent After the Burial record is fucking riff-tastic. Jesus.
Oh yeah, those guys are awesome, man. I'm really looking forward to seeing them. And Yeah, man.
That fucking opening song is so.
Yeah, it's killer. They rule at what they do, man, for sure. And I look forward to seeing it. But yeah, man, I'm excited about the tour. I'm choosing to stay positive.
Yes.
Let's go. Let's get me out there. Let's fucking do this.
Buy them fucking tickets, motherfuckers.
Yeah, buy the tickets, man.
I appreciate you being on here, man. You were an awesome guest. And thanks for
having me, dude.
Thanks for being so open with, you know, all your struggles and all the stuff you've been going through. And I absolutely wish you the best with this tour, man.
Hey, thanks, man. Thanks so much.
Yeah, dude. Ladies and gentlemen, right there, the mighty, mighty Trevor Black Dahlia Murder here on No Fucking Regrets.
No fucking regrets!
With Robb Flynn.